Okay, so this is a continuation of the Board of Selectmen meeting for Tuesday, January 24th. We'll continue with the Pledge of Allegiance, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, we began this evening in executive session. And we'll continue now with item number 2 on the agenda. And there's agendas available if anybody's interested. Residents are invited to share ideas, opinions, or ask questions regarding their town government in our public forum session. Is there anyone here that would like to address the board this evening? There's a lot of people here, but no one wants to address us yet. Okay, so we'll pass on that for now. Next up, staff appointments and retirements. Chief Lee. Chief, if you would join us, please, at the guest table and walk us through some things with the personnel at the police department. Hi, Dave.
I'd like to introduce you. I'm sure you all know him, Detective Dave Shane. He's been a member of the Hopkinton Police Department and law enforcement now for 24 exceptional years of service to the town and to the community. Anyone you ever speak to about Dave, they speak to them in the highest praises. That's past chiefs, supervisors, officers, member of the community, and member of the law enforcement community, which he's had the opportunity several occasions to work with and in his detective duties. I've had the honor to work with Dave for the past 3 years in his assignment as detectives. Dave has certainly stepped up to help me in my transition. He took over the court officer's job. It was always under the command of a sergeant, and he was able to do an outstanding job at the same time handling his caseloads. Dave also stepped up to the plate to take over the transformation of the evidence room. That was one of the priorities when I came here as chief, and I can honestly say Dave did an exceptional job in bringing up the standards of that evidence room, which you read a lot in the headlines when it comes to the police department. He brought it up to national accreditation standards, and I'm very proud of his work. We will certainly miss his dedication and experience. I know I've sent it several times, and we can see a lot of the retirees, a lot of experience in the back room, and it's tough to replace. And I personally will miss Dave's candidness, which was in a respectful manner, and always looking to move the department forward in the best interests of this community. And the town of Hopkinton is truly missing a great employee. Congratulations.
Well, thank you, Chief. Thank you.
Dave, have you prepared a speech for your retirement party?
I have not.
Anything you'd like to say?
Just it was a great career working here. I came from the small town of Mendon, and I loved it here. And it was just time to go. I did my 30 years, but it was a great place to work. Still is, and we got a great department.
So great.
We're very lucky. You guys are very lucky.
Great. We are indeed. It's great to see you here this evening. We're sorry to see you go. It's also great to see other retirees here this evening coming back to celebrate with you and thank you for your service. I think that says an awful lot about your service, but it also says an awful lot about the department and all the work that you guys have done over the years. There's some gentlemen in the back and ladies from all over Hopkinton here tonight to say thanks, and it's great to see all them with you here too. Brennan.
Well, I'm always the first guy to go. I've known Dave Shane professionally for 24 years. He's a great guy, and he is a product of his environment. Those guys you see in the back, as well as Dave, those are the guys that were the kids. They didn't really fear you guys because you took a more hands-on approach. You took a caring approach. There was none of the, you didn't rule by hammer. You gave everyone a fair shot. If they were fair with you, and I assure you, I am the recipient. If I'm fair with you, you would be fair with me. And I appreciate that more than you have a clue to you guys and the guys in the back. So personally, I'll miss you a lot around town. Professionally, more than you know. And hopefully that you guys, the passing of the torch to the newer guys that are here, they can learn from from what you've done. And the people that are in the kind of the mid-range that haven't been here for the 30 years, they've only been here for 20, maybe they can bring these guys up to speed and aspire, these new officers aspire to be to the character that you guys are. Thank you.
Mrs. Wright.
Thank you, Officer Shane, for your service. And as everyone has said, we're, of course, always sorry to see one of our police force go, because we appreciate them all. And I just continue to marvel at what a great job, what a solid police force we have, and the good community relations we have. We probably all noticed that just shortly, Hopkinton was reported as, I believe it was, the fifth safest medium-sized community in Massachusetts. Fourth?
Okay. He was trying to get your attention. He's going like this.
Even better. I mean,
not that he's taking credit for it, really.
This is the reason you and all these officers who've served for so many years are the ones that got us to where we are. So thank you for your service.
Thank you.
Mr. Catino.
Yeah, I just think it's great looking out, and it's just apropos with Brendan coming on and you right here, just to see that the shoes that it's going to take to fill. Look in the back there, all the experience that we've had. And I actually, you probably don't remember, about a dozen years ago, maybe 15 years ago, some checks were stolen from my house, and you helped crack it. And not that anything ever happened. I went to court 10 times, and they just threw it out. But it really helped I went to the police department and it was taken care of, and you were the detective on it, and I really appreciate it. So even professionally, it was great. So thank you very much, and looking forward to your party.
Mr. Sestari is stuck on the pike, I think, trying to get out from the airport, so he's unable to be here at this time. We expect him at some point this evening. His father's a police officer, was a police officer, and he takes these retirements and these new hires. He's really into it, and he really appreciates being part of the process. I'm sure he's disappointed not to be here to say thank you. So on behalf of Mr. Sestari as well, thank you for a great job, and you will be missed.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks again, Dave.
Thank you.
Good luck. Mr. Oh, I'm sorry. Hold on.
Yes.
Mr. Kamal, on to the business matters now.
Yes. Through the chair. Hopkinton is fortunate to have many employees who have worked for the town for numerous years. Some employees work year-round, while others work on a sporadic, seasonal, or limited basis. Regardless of their status, we as a community benefit from the experience and dedication of long-term staff and staff members. And on behalf of the community, the Board of Selectmen, and your friends here at Town Hall, I'm presenting you with a gift certificate to a vendor of your choosing.
Okay, good luck, Dave.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks for coming tonight. Chief Lee.
Okay, out with the old and with the new now. Sorry.
What was that guy's name? Who's next?
If I could have Officer Brendan Lyra have a seat. Thank you. Brendan Lyra is a lifelong resident of Charlton. He attended the St. Peter Marion Junior High School and Shepherd Hill High School. where he was a captain of the varsity lacrosse team. His true athletic passion was ice hockey, which he played 6 years, high-level competitive junior hockey. He also, in his off time, is a hockey official, referee. He attended Quinn Sigman Junior College, and in January 2015, while at Quinn Sigman, he was given the opportunity to attend the Western Mass Police Academy in Springfield. He had was sponsored and did that on his own own time and his own dollar, and that certainly shows his dedication. Upon graduation from the academy, he was hired by the UMass Police Department of Worcester. After a year there, he was fortunate enough to be a candidate on our list. He scored extremely well and did extremely well in his oral interview. His background check, while we are running it, one thing that stuck out from past supervisors, only having a year on the job and working in a hectic place as UMass Medical Center, was his ability to de-escalate situations. And that's pretty impressive for a young officer at that age. And that also came out in his oral interview as well, and he really stressed, and you don't always see this young officer, the importance of empathy towards people and their problems. And he's certainly going to be a good addition to this police department. He comes from a law enforcement background. His father is here tonight. Chief William Liver is with us. We'll be pinning the badge if you so move on his appointment. And I'd like to present you with Officer Liver.
Just like to thank you for having me here tonight. It's quite an honor to be sitting here right now.
Great. We're glad to have you as well.
Thank you.
Mrs. Wright.
More to say, I take the Chief's fine accolades to say, assuming we approve this appointment, I think we're going to be very grateful and proud to have Brendan on our force. Glad you're here.
Mr. Catino.
Yeah, just looking at his the pride in his father's face while you're up there, it says it all for me. I know we're going to be lucky to have you. And not to steal maybe some of his thunder, but being a hockey ref, that's how I can see how we can definitely de-escalate.
Brandon's going to want to know if he got into fights while playing hockey.
No, but that's definitely going to be some really great training, especially now that it's just being a police officer. It's just so tough now. Kudos to you for sticking it out and wanting to do it in such a tough time, and we just want you to know as a board, as a town, we will always be behind you. It's a tough job, but we thank you for doing it. We thank all the officers and our retired officers because it's a tough job, and we're really glad that we have people like you doing it. But thank you for doing it.
Thank you, sir.
Mr. Ted Stone.
Well, welcome aboard. I like to see, when we get officers or people in this profession, I love to see that you come from a generational. So the fact that your dad was in it, obviously he's instilled enough pride in the position to make you want to, of all the careers you could have chosen, you chose to be a police officer. Even though you're new on the job and relatively new to the occupation, you've lived it for the last, I'm not allowed to ask how old you are, but I'm going to guess somewhere between 15 and 40 years. So I think that's great. The hockey player, obviously, I'm looking at your hair. You've got hockey out of your system because you don't have the long hair. And the referee, well, I'm not a big fan of referees, so.
You're going to look past that one on his resume?
Yeah. I won't get it.
Brendan redacted that part of the resume.
So congratulations, welcome aboard, and we're lucky to have you.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
The Chief said a word that really jumped out at me, and the word was empathy. And I think that's a great skill to have in any profession. Certainly if you're in the world of public service in any fashion, to have empathy and to understand how other people are thinking and feeling is a great skill set, and I think it'll help you do a great job. We're glad to have you, Brandon, and look forward to seeing you out on the streets of Hopkinton soon.
Thank you very much. I look forward to it.
Welcome aboard. Chief, would you like to lead the presentation of the pin?
Absolutely.
Chief?
There you go. Sonny had to be all right.
That's awesome. Chief, I believe you have one more. I'm not sure where you're going just yet.
Yep. The last two requests for a dispatcher, Brandon Louise, who's been a full-time dispatcher for over a year now. If their performance is up to par, we allow them to apply for a special police officer in order to work details, traffic only. Him and Detective Shane will also be seeking the special appointment so Dave can still be with us on a limited basis to work as a details.
Could we, as I said with when Griff went to, could we just take a quick look at his resume?
Okay.
make sure.
Okay, don't read into my question, please. Don't read into my question. Mr. Kamal, Dave Shane's not listed on here as going to special.
He is.
Oh, it's separate item. Never mind. Scratch my question. Okay, all set. All right, anything else, Chief?
No, that's it.
So the chair will entertain a motion to appoint David Shane and Braden Louise as special officers for the town of Hopkinton.
So moved.
Second.
Mr. Kamal, is the motion in order?
Yes.
Chief, that's what you need?
Yes, Mr. Chair.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Aye. Any opposed? Okay, that's all set. Mr. Kamal, we have to vote to confirm the appointment of Brandon Liver, correct?
Vote to appoint.
So we vote to appoint, yes. Not to confirm.
Correct.
Okay.
Motion to appoint Brandon Liver to a full-time police officer for the Hopkinton Police Department.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? All those in favor? Aye. Any opposed? It's unanimous. And then finally, we don't have to accept the retirement. That sort of happens, so. Unfortunately, we can vote not to accept it, I guess. Okay, I think we're all set. Chief, you good?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Appreciate it.
Thank you. Okay, moving right along here. So we're going to go to item number 3, which is the consent agenda. We have minutes from January 10th, 17. We have a marathon fund request of $1,500 to stock the pond for the annual fishing derby in May. We have a gift of $50 to the ambulance fund from Donna and Edgar Nordstrom of Portland, Oregon, in memory of Mrs. McIntyre, Beverly McIntyre. There's a one-day liquor license request for St. Patrick's Day fundraiser at St. John's Church for Project Just Because. And the board is being asked to accept the resignation of Ziki Liu, I believe I'm close there, from the Youth Commission. The Board of Assessors has a vacancy. The Board of Selectmen will announce. We'll come back to that. There's a vacancy on the Board of Assessors. And finally, a proclamation for an Eagle Scout as well. I'd like to break out items number 7 and item 6. Anybody else want to break anything out of the consent agenda? Everybody else good? Chair will entertain a motion to approve the consent agenda items 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Okay. Item 6 of the consent agenda, Board of Assessors vacancy. The Board of Selectmen will announce a vacancy on the Board of Assessors. Mr. Kamalo. We have one vacancy on the Board of Assessors?
Correct.
Okay. And that will be to fill a term through next May, or would that be a longer term? How would that work for the Board of Assessors?
It's specifically to fill the remainder of, if you give me one second.
Thank you. Town clerk is with us.
Mr. Chair,
yeah.
I was just confirming that the position will be filled until the next election.
Next election.
Yes.
Mr. Deegan, you concur?
That is true, and then it will go up for a one-year term for election during May.
Got it. Okay. All right, so we do have a vacancy on the Board of Assessors. If anybody's interested, please reach out to the town manager's office or to the town clerk's office, and we'll help you walk through the process. Would that be a joint meeting to make that appointment?
Yes, it will be a joint meeting between the selectmen and the remaining members of the Board of Assessors.
Okay, so Board of Assessors, if anybody's interested. Tax policy. I'm sorry?
Dr.
Yeah, and a great seat to fill. Tough shoes to fill, though. Tough shoes. Number 7 on the consent agenda is one of those things that we get to do every now and then in Hopkinton. We're fortunate to do it somewhat routinely, but it's always amazing what happens when we do this. So at this time, I'd like to ask Eagle Scout Michael Asher Greystone to please join us at the guest table. Right here, Michael. Welcome. And I'm going to start with Mrs. Wright introducing Michael a little bit and talking about a couple of things that she's aware of, and then we'll go from there. Michael, hang out for a little bit. We're going to keep you here for a while. Mrs. Wright.
Well, we're so pleased to see Michael here, and I'm so pleased to get this chance to honor him a second time. I had the privilege to represent the Board of Selectmen at his Eagle Scout Court of Honor, which was held on January 15th. And I first met this young man when he was a little 6 or 7 year old with his scout pack who toured our home learning about Hopkinton history. And it's hard to believe that it's only been 7 years, and here he is, he's an Eagle Scout. I think we can all be just proud and amazed at what this outstanding young man has accomplished. He's only 13, and he's already achieved the rank of Eagle Scout, which, as you know, is scouting's highest honor. Scouts have up until age 18 to achieve that. Michael Scott set out right from the start that that was his goal, and he was going to do it in record time. But as you can see from his sash, he didn't cut any corners. Each one of his merit badges represents one of the merit ranks that he achieved. He only was required to achieve, I believe it was 21, if I'm not correct, out of a possible 135. He has already achieved 117.
Wow.
With a goal to achieve all 135, and at the rate he's going, they're going to have to come up with some other badges because he'll be there pretty soon. I hope Michael will tell us a little about his Eagle Scout project, but he did a wonderful Eagle Scout project as well as an endeavor on an earlier planned Eagle Scout project, which took a year and a half and ran into government bureaucracy. So he had a life experience right there in doing this and not succumbing to discouragement, but moving ahead to give this wonderful giving back to his community and to his house of worship. And through this project and through all I learned about Michael, he is a true leader. We expect to see great things from Michael. He thoroughly demonstrates the Eagle Scouts' code of honor and loyalty and courage, which are represented in his red, white, and blue Eagle Scout pin or badge that he now has. So I'm so proud that he can be here tonight and look forward to his sharing with you all what he's accomplished.
We have done this as a board numerous times over the years. Mr. Sestari and I are in our third term, so I don't know how many times we've had Eagle Scouts come through. We've never, ever, ever had a 13-year-old Eagle Scout. So that in itself is unbelievable and just a fantastic accomplishment. It's such a young age. You should be very proud. I'm sure your parents are very proud. They got cameras out, so they must be. So it's just great, great to see you. Michael, do us a favor, please. Tell us, tell the community, tell everybody watching on TV, tell us what you did for your Eagle Scout project.
So for my Eagle Scout project, the first time, like Ms. Wright said, I tried to do a bridge at my school in Southboro, the Faye School. There was a football field in the back where a bridge used to be, and that over time collapsed. So I was going to do a 28-foot bridge over that span, and I was working with a engineer, Mr. Lowell in Hopkinton, to do that. And I did a year and a half with this project, and then I sent it to the ADA because, I couldn't have any supports in the water because it was a secondary drinking source for Boston. So it had to be a high slope. And so when I sent it to the ADA, they denied it because the slope was too much of an incline for people with like wheelchairs to go over it. And then the project that I actually completed for my Eagle, I did at my synagogue in Westboro. They had a playground that was in need of repair and new toys. So I donated toys and threw out all of the old toys that were broken and that were hazardous to the children. And I scrubbed down the whole thing, and we weeded and took out planters. And
so you mentioned a second project, and that was with the toys over in Westboro. Why was there a second project?
That was because when I went to the ADA to get my project they denied it because of the slope of the...
So they denied and wouldn't let you do anything?
Yeah, they were going to let me appeal January 10th, I think, and that was too far for me. So, and I wanted to get it done faster, so I decided to do another project. Although, someone is still, we said yes to the appeal, but I'm not going to be there doing the appeal.
You can pass the project to somebody else. Yes. Yeah, excellent, excellent. So is this the government regulation that you were talking about?
And a lot of people would have given up and taken a break, and he said, nope, I'm going to get that Eagle Scout regardless and started a whole another project. So, tremendous perseverance.
Yeah, that's great. That's amazing. Amazing stuff. Really cool. Mr. Tedstone.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
So I listened to Mrs. Wright eloquently describe everything that you mean to her. And I noticed you were staring at the table the whole time. And then I listened to you tell us everything that you did. And there weren't a lot of eyes in there. There were a lot of weeds. So it shows that you're a very selfless person. And you don't want the spotlight on you. It's more of a team approach rather than an individual approach, and that's very, very admirable. It's very admirable to you for you to have that at a young age of 13 to show that. I think that's wonderful, and it's a testament to you as a person. It's a testament to your parents, the way they brought you up, and congratulations. Wonderful job.
Thank you.
Mr. Catino.
Yeah, 13, that's just incredible. We had, I think somebody was 14 a year or so ago. But 13, and it's funny because, one of the things I always said to people was, make sure that you, put your Eagle Scout credentials somewhere near your license, so God forbid something happens, you get pulled over by one of Hopkinton's finest or something. They liked seeing that kind of stuff. They kind of respect and realize that it was just a minor transgression. But you're not going to be driving for a few more years, so you don't need to worry about that part. But, no, it's just great that... That you've taken on such adult responsibilities at this age, and you're forging a great path. Congratulations, and keep up that great work.
Thank you.
Mr. Sestari.
Is there a badge for getting all the badges?
No. There should be, though.
I think that's the Eagle Scout badge, right?
Absolutely. Well, congratulations, Michael. Obviously, we're honored to have you as part of our community. We need more people who are willing to not just set a goal, but to surpass their goal. And clearly, if the Eagle Scouts are in the top 5% of Scouts, I'm sure you're in the top 5% of Eagle Scouts, if not higher, just with your accomplishments. Can you tell us a little bit more about the project? I know that there are different things. You need to get other people involved as well. And can you tell us about how you got people to help you out? And do you have anybody, whether it's a store or neighbors or anything like that, that you'd like to thank for the help?
Yeah, so my first project, like I said, I had to go through multiple stages. So I talked to the Conservation Commission, DCR, the Trails Committee. And then my second project, I had a lot of help when I did it with all my fellow scouts, and I wouldn't have been able to do it without them.
So, how'd you talk them into it?
To get higher in the ranks of Boy Scouts, you need service hours. Mm-hmm. So that would count towards some of them, so that helped a lot. And some of them helped me because I'm friends with a lot of them.
Great.
And so I'd like to thank all of them.
Great. And where'd you get, you said that you replaced some of the toys and things like that. Did you get people to donate money or donate toys, or were there any stores that helped you or anything like that?
So we bought all of our stuff off Amazon, and I already had prior money from raising toward the other project, which never happened. So I used some of that money, and the congregation also had some. Mm-hmm. So together we had the sufficient of funds.
Great. Well, congratulations.
Thank you very much.
It's amazing the skills that these young men learn earning their Eagle Scout. I mean, look how he's sitting. You know, Michael, you're sitting there. You are in control of the situation. I mean, you're just doing an awesome job, and it's all the skills that you learned working in the Scouts over the years are all coming right out right now before all these folks. There's a lot of people here talking about Trails Committee. There's a lot of people here from the Trails Committee in town that could probably use your help someday down the road here soon too. So keep up the great work, and thanks so much for coming. Mrs. Wright.
I just want to say one more thing about Michael, because we can all see the badges that he's wearing, but I learned so much about the Eagle Scout merit and the Court of Honor, and when you see Michael or when you see an Eagle Scout and you notice the red, white, and blue neckerchief that he's been given to recognize his achievement, I think it's really important that everyone here understand what that red, white, and blue neckerchief means. It's easy to understand the badges, but that red, white, and blue speaks to what Michael is, because in the Eagle Scout rank, the white says that he's a man of honor, and the blue says that he's a man of loyalty, and the red that he's a man of courage. So the fact that he's earned the right to wear this kerchief indicates that when you see this young man, those are the qualities that he exemplifies and are expressed in him. So understand what is meant by what he's wearing.
That's great. And that comes from his work in the Scouts, and that comes from his mother and his father and all those others in his life that have, you know, been part of his upbringing. Mr. Catino has something he would like to read to you. I believe you have seen this to date, but we want to read it publicly so all of Hopkinton can hear it.
So the town of Hopkinton, the Hopkinton Board of Selectmen, hereby recognizes Eagle Scout recipient Michael Asher Greystone, Boy Scout Troop Number 4, Hopkinton, Massachusetts, Boy Scouts of America. Therefore, the Board of Selectmen of the town of Hopkinton, Massachusetts, joined with Michael's family, friends, in recognition of his achievement in attaining the rank of Eagle Scout, signed under the hand of this seal, January 24th, 2017, Brian Harris, Chair, John Catino, Vice Chair, Claire Wright, Todd Sestari, and Brendan Tedstone.
Congratulations, Michael. Well done.
Young man. Yeah.
I don't see anybody jumping at that, so that's all right.
Thank you very much. Great job.
Great job, Michael. Great job, Mom and Dad. Congratulations. Well done.
To get a longer sash for the rest of your badges that you're going
to
earn?
Yes. So I'll have to cut the end and then sew on more on the back.
Will that be another badge?
Sewing badge.
The home ec badge?
I don't know.
Congratulations.
Good luck. Michael. Thanks, Michael. Okay, next up, it's tough to follow that, but we will move on. Number four on the agenda is annual license renewals. We had done the annual license renewals back in December. At that time, there was a couple that we extended because we had to get some application information. Mr. Kamala, is that correct? Or finalize some application information?
Yes, that's correct. And Maria has reviewed the applications together with the permitting office teams, and she's recommending approval of the licenses.
And those two licenses are?
The first is for NYNE Equipment, doing business as Vermeer Northeast at 24 South Street. And then the next one is Sodexo EMC Dell. They have four locations, 42, 171, 176, and 228 South Street.
Okay. Chair will entertain a motion to approve the licenses for both NYNE Equipment LLC, doing business as Vermeer Northeast, and Sodexo EMC Dell, doing business at 42, 171, 176, and 228 South Street.
Chair.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any discussion? All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? It's unanimous and so carries. Item number five, the Pratt Farm Master Plan team request for Scout and the Scout facility discussion. We just saw what amazing thing Scouts do in Hopkinton through Michael. But we wanted to talk a little bit tonight, and I don't know, yeah, we do have George here. George, if you could join us at the guest table for a couple minutes. Is Jen here, or she was at another meeting?
She's at another meeting and was hoping you could pinch hit for her.
Okay, so I can, because this is the Pratt Farm Master Plan team. I serve as a member of that team as appointed by the board. So I can speak to a little bit of what's going on, but I'm going to let Mr. Kamala sort of introduce the overall concept of what's happening, and I'll speak. I'll figure out when to speak on behalf of that board. Mr. Kamala, and I don't have any conflicts here. This is no, just I'm on two boards. Mr. Kamala.
Yes, through the chair, you will all recall that when the town purchased the Pratt Farm, there were some uses that were identified as prospective uses for the property. One of them was the location of a scouting lodge on the property. There was also the discussion regarding the potential for a well that will augment our water supply in the town. We have completed some preliminary work identifying where the wells could be located on the property. We have also identified areas that could be reserved as buffers around wetland and floodplain areas. Based on the information collected, it has become apparent that locating a scout lodge on this property would be almost impossible. And that's the reason why we are here tonight.
So, just to add a little bit more color to that, there was, you know, we bought the land for water, and we bought the land for scouting, lodge, someplace, and we bought the land for passive recreation. Those were the three drivers discussed at town meeting. Those were the three drivers, I think, that the board used at that time to present the acquisition or purchase of the land to town meeting. And I think that's why it went through. The trails, still very much in play. We, speaking as the Pratt Farm team now, we can get more trails, obviously, there. No problem. The water has proved to, we've done some preliminary testing. We spent a little bit of money that we got through the governor's
compact
recently. And the land looks like it's good, as we thought, for water. I mean, it's over in that area where the wells are across the street and so on. But the Scout Lodge, when you take those wells and you put that 400-foot circle around the well head, and you draw those, it's 400 feet, right? You draw those in, and then you look at the wetlands that are in that area because it's fairly flat, so you get some wet over there. You put all that together, the Scout Lodge, it just doesn't fit. So we could put the Scout Lodge in there and do nothing else. But even doing that, we would have to use a shoehorn to get it in with the wetlands and the setbacks and so on. Or we can not put the Scout Lodge there and consider putting it somewhere else, and then use the land for one of the other major, two of the major purposes, water, a future water well site, and for trails. That's kind of like where we are. George is here from the Hopkinton Scouting Association to maybe make a couple comments specific to what they've looked at and why they're concerned about it too. And then we really tonight, I think, correct me if I'm wrong, Mr. Kamala, we wanted to just bring this to the board's attention. I don't know if we need to get into the debate tonight or the deliberations tonight about where we might send the Scout Lodge elsewhere in town if we want to sort of do a land swap of sorts. And certainly Fruit Street could be one of those possible discussions because there's a lot of other things that didn't go on the Fruit Street land that we bought. We probably should save that for another day, but we just want to get everybody up to speed on what's going on. George.
Yeah, so, you know, the piece of property is beautiful, right? It would be perfect for the Scout Lodge. And really what we ran into is that there's setbacks from the stream that goes through there, 200 feet back from the stream. And then there's setbacks from the pond, 75 feet from the pond, which leaves a little narrow strip where we have to put a road, and then where we're about, you know, where we had planned to put the scout house and the parking lot and everything else, when you look at the buffer around the wells, it cuts right through the middle of the parking lot. And because it's an assembly space, it drives the amount of parking spaces we have to have with, you know, the occupancy that we'd have to have for that assembly space, the size. So that's really what it comes down to, is that we, as it was, just trying to fit it in with all the setbacks. And there's actually wetlands behind it as well, so it just barely fits in. And then you've got the, you know, the remaining Pratt property line comes right up against the edge on the other side. So it's really, you know, to Brian's point, it's a shoehorn to get it in there, and it would be kind of tough. So there would be some site work required for us to be able to even get it in there. There's some floodplain that we would have to take care of. We'd have to get, you know, approval from Army Corps of Engineers, etc. So it's really tough for us to get the property in there, the scout house in there.
Okay. Does anybody have any questions specific to the scout organization about kind of where we are at this time?
Nope. Well, I was just wondering, could you just put off-site parking somewhere over at Fruit Street or something? And, scouts, yeah,
I think the zoning bylaws require certain on-site, has to be on-site.
Okay, that's right.
It's an assembly use, so I think that drives it.
Right. It's you know, the Hopkins and Scout Leaders Association, which is, you know, the organization that I represent, represents all of the scouting community. So it's the Girl Scouts, Boy Scouts, Cub Scouts in town. And the Girl Scouts really drive the largest assembly requirements. It's they have the biggest membership. So that's really what's driving most of our need for the space. The two Boy Scout troops in town and the two Cub Scout packs in town, not as big of a membership as the Girl Scouts are. So, but combined together and trying to share the space and everything else, it's just, you know, we just need that assembly area, you know, the building size to be as it is with the kitchen and everything else that we need, classrooms, etc.
All right, so with that, I would suggest that we just table the topic for now with the understanding that we have alternatives. At some point, Mr. Sestari, were you going to jump in there?
Nope.
Okay. Everybody okay with tabling? Mr. Kamali, yes. Good with tabling for now? I think we're aware.
Yes, and if board members in between meetings think of what other considerations could be brought to bear to this discussion, please reach out to Elaine or Jennifer and let her know.
Okay. Jen in the planning office, she's also on, she's the staff helping us on that committee. All right.
Sounds good.
George, thank you very much for coming tonight, and we will table it and start thinking about next steps.
Great. Thank you.
All right. Have a good night. Okay. Item number six, the Upper Charles Trails Committee discussion. Let me just look ahead here. Special town meeting. Annual town meeting. Mr. Kamala, the manager's report is nothing time-consuming in there, right? I don't see anything. I mean,
just the introduction to
intro.
The FY18.
Intro. Focused on intro, right? Okay. All right. So with that, we're going to move into the trails discussion for tonight. We're running a little bit behind schedule, but that's why I was just checking ahead here. We're going to keep to the hour, so we won't sort of cut anybody off or cut the discussion off per se. So that's the first thing I want to make clear. We'll wrap this up at 8:40. And just so everybody understands, I look up there a lot as I'm running the meeting because there's a clock up there. And in situations like this, the clock becomes very important. So I'm not ignoring anybody if anybody's chatting.
Upper left hand.
But if I'm looking up there, that's why, just so you know. Okay, so let's talk about process for a couple minutes if we could, please. We have three items we want to discuss tonight specific to the Upper Charles Trails Committee. The first, we're going to get an update from Jane Moran and all the volunteers that have worked so hard to date on the Upper Charles Trails Committee to try and piece some things together in town. The second item is we've got to sort through some conflict of interest disclosure forms, and this is a matter of law. This is no more than that, no less than that. It is what it is. And then the third item is, and that they're kind of interrelated, all these are interrelated, specifically B and C though. The third item is we've got to consider whether or not we want to review or revise the charge of the committee that was issued by the board some time ago, or maybe just steer it or redirect it, whatever. We'll figure out what those words are at that time. So, again, we're going to talk about process here for 5 minutes because I see a lot of folks in the room and we want to get everybody to buy in on what we're about to do. Jane, you're going to take about 15 minutes.
Yes.
Is that correct?
That is correct.
And that 15 minutes is you presenting to us, but not us necessarily asking questions
correct.
Of you. Okay, so we're going to let Jane go do her thing for 15 minutes, okay? And that will be Jane and Jane alone, or is there going to be other people presenting?
No, we're trying to get this computer up, but it's just going to be me.
Okay, so do we have a problem with the presentation?
I'm trying to pull it up.
She's got it.
It's on
the computer.
Okay, so while Jane's doing that, let me just go a little bit further with process.
It's Hopkinton News. Yes, and then after the presentation, I would just like to ask the board for a moment, either before your vote, so that I could speak to
it's right there.
The committee change, the language change that you're proposing.
Okay, so we'll get to that in a little bit. Okay, so the first 15 minutes, we're going to have Jane give her presentation, and that will be Jane giving the presentation, and no one will be jumping in and saying, wait a minute, Jane, I want you to say this, or I want you to say that, but we do. So we want to just keep it to Jane presenting to the board. And I'm being very obvious, folks, in what I'm describing here, because in a few minutes, I'm going to ask everyone to raise their hand if they agree to this process. Okay, because this is a charged issue in town, and this is the best way to manage it we've learned over the years. Then, after Jane makes her presentation, the board is going to have an opportunity, the board and Mr. Kamala, to have a little dialogue with Jane. Okay, so that's going to be about 20 minutes. Then we're going to have 20 minutes where we talk about the conflict of interest disclosure forms and any action the board might have to take. That is going to be interrelated to the charge piece of this discussion, which is item C on here, which is, are we going to talk about any possible committee charge adjustments or changes, okay? And depending on how we go through Jane's presentation and then these next two presentations, we'll figure out if we have time for some public comment. So let me describe what I mean by time for some public comment. This is a public meeting, okay? You are all members of the public. This is your government. This is your town. You pay for all this. We all pay for this. But at a public meeting, by law, you are here to observe, okay? By tradition in Hopkinton, whenever we can, we try to get some public input when there's an issue that's before the board that has some energy behind it, okay? Because it makes people feel part of the process. We get some good input, and it helps us deliberate the situation or sort through the situation. Sometimes, however, that public comment in a public meeting can get out of hand, okay? And that has happened. It has happened in Hopkinton, this great town. Every now and then it gets out of hand. If that were to happen tonight, I will end it in about a half second flat, okay? So please understand, we cannot let this get out of control tonight. There's a lot of people in this room. I can see them out here right now. A lot of folks have one position, and a lot of folks have another position, okay? So our job, my job in particular, is to be the heavy here and control this as we sort through the challenges, the questions, the concerns, and the passions that all of us have, okay? So we're going to try and get some public comment tonight. When we do, if we get a chance to do public comment, I'll be looking at the clock. You will have 2 minutes, okay? 2 minutes to either ask a question, 2 minutes to make a comment, 2 minutes to present your view, and that'll be it. There will not be any 5-minute dissertations or 10-minute dissertations. We can't do that. We don't have time to do that tonight, and it's not fair to all the other folks in the room, okay? So that'll be another piece of the puzzle that everybody has to understand. And with all due respect, I will have to cut you off if you start to ramble on, okay? 2 minutes, you can get your point known. And everybody in here has a position pretty much already. I can tell you right now, you all know where you're coming from on this thing. Say what you want to say and wrap it up, okay? Because we want to get everybody to get a chance to voice their opinion. And after that, if we have time to do that, and I keep going back to if we have time to do that, we'll try and make some decisions here tonight within this hour, okay? So we've got a lot to do. We've got to really focus, and I hope the process I've just outlined is agreeable to everybody. Let me start with my colleagues. Is everybody agreeable with that process?
Yes.
Anybody concerned with the process? Anybody concerned with the number of people that might come and share their views?
You're cutting it off at 2 minutes. You're cutting it off at 2 minutes.
Okay.
It is what it is.
Yeah, and I know you'll throw some at me if I don't.
You're right, I will.
We're all good with the process.
Yes.
Okay, so this is where audience participation comes in. Is everybody okay with the process that I've outlined? Does anybody have any concerns about the process? Speak now or forever hold your peace. Okay, so with that, we're going to go ahead and get into the Upper Trails discussion with everybody in agreement to the process, okay? So now we can all police each other if something gets out of control. Okay? Ms. Moran.
Thank you. I really want to thank the board for inviting us here tonight so that we can come forward and give an update to the board. We're really excited to share with you our progress, and I think you're going to be surprised by the amount of work the committee has put into this project over the last 6 months. Next slide. So we're going to have a brief overview and a history. We're going to tell you about what we've done in the last 6 months, and then we're going to talk about our future plans, including funding sources and a timeline. And then at the end, there'll be time for comments or questions. So the committee has been around for a few years, and it took us a while, actually, to get our bearings. And the Upper Charles Trail vision is actually a vision that was handed down to us from the state. They decided that they wanted to take all of these abandoned railroad beds across the state and turn it into a Rails for Trails project. That's what they called it. So our section of this piece is called the Upper Charles Trail. There are a lot of other sections, and they have different names. We are in the middle of a 5-town section, so this is really important to remember. We have Milford and Holliston to our south, Hopkinton in the middle, and then we have Sherburn and Ashland to our east. So the idea of connectivity is really vital to the state, and that's where the piece we have to remember, because that's vital to the funding piece. Next slide. So before we get too far into the discussion, I would really like to spend a little bit of time talking about classification of trails. It's important to understand that there are five different types of trails, and this actually comes down from the federal government, where a lot of the money for, that gives to the state for these trails, and the state has to follow that process if they are going to be able to disperse this funding. So you can think of a class 1, 2, or 3 trail system as being a type of a trail that has a native type of tread. They all have that in common. A class 1 is just a path through the woods, you know, like walk, just an animal path. Number 2 is something in your neighborhood that you might take walk your dog through. And class 3 is something that gets a little bit wider. There are more people using it, and you might find a few bridge structures. And there is some maintenance. Maybe you have to cut a tree once every 3 years or something so that you can use that trail. Now, a class 4 trail is similar to our center trail, and it begins to have structures, bridges, and drainage. Maintenance has to be monitored. The grades can't be more than 12%. You heard a little bit about that from their previous Boy Scout speaker. He got knocked off because he didn't meet the qualifications for the grades. And actually, abandoned railroad beds are perfect for this because this is what you can start with for a class 4 or class 5 trail. The structures are already in place, it's wide enough, and there's drainage accountability in a lot of these. Next slide. So then we go on and we talk about a class 5, and this must meet all of the accessibility requirements of state and federal guidelines. It has to allow for 2 lanes and 2 directions for travel. The tread is usually stone dust or crushed stone, but more commonly it's asphalt. And a class 5 meets the highest priority for state funding. Important to next slide. So our committee also decided early on that we wanted to be able to tie in our trail into our existing town facilities. We want to further enhance our recreational opportunities between the schools and the neighborhoods and our downtown businesses. We also realized early on, after reaching out to a few neighborhoods, that they really don't welcome this wide Class 5 trail system through the middle of their neighborhood. So after a year or so, we reached out, we heard about the Conway School, and we hired them to assist us with a 50,000-foot visioning project. Now, the Conway School is a graduate school that specializes in community planning, and they provided us with many potential possibilities. They spoke also to the challenge that we have because most of our railroad bed, unlike Hopkinton or Holliston, has been purchased by over 50 property owners. So that's kind of a unique challenge that we have, not insurmountable. However, one concept that they provided stood out and is worth mentioning, and that is the concept of building a multi-use path along Main Street toward the downtown district up to the town common. Next slide. So a little bit more to explain about our focus on Main Street. Remember, our overall goal is to connect Ashland to Milford. So they helped us with a visioning project of what this Main Street would look like. So we took certain elements out of the Conway plan and discussed it with state and town officials who adopted these changes, and which now include a single 10-foot wide multi-use path along Main Street. So we envision that's going to keep the users safe while they travel along one side of the road. And this design will also allow motorists to be more aware that there is a large trail coming ahead and hopefully slow them down. And the added design safety features that will be built in, trees and curbing and other barriers, will keep both cyclists and pedestrians safe along our Main Street. Next slide. So this is a vision of what could possibly look like from Center Trail through our downtown district up to the town common. And this is just conceptual only, but this is part of the possibilities that we could achieve. Next slide. So hopefully, now that you might have a little bit of better understanding of the different types of clear trail classifications, you might understand our committee's sensitivity to the residents who live in established residents and who are reluctant to experience such a large change in their lifestyle. Next slide. So this chart is interesting in that it provides information how other towns have built their trails. You'll notice the number of years it took Milford to complete their trail, 18 years. Holliston is up to 13 years, and the Bruce Freeman Trail is more like 8 or 9 so far. Bruce Freeman Trail is located in Acton. And there's both Holliston and Bruce Freeman are still under construction. So Milford was the first to start in our area, and they were able to tap into federal funding that is no longer available. The Bruce Freeman Trail, however, received state funding. They only had to pay 10% of their construction costs. Holliston chose a different route, and they used CPC fundings, donations, and volunteers to get their trail done. Next slide. So that brings us up to what we have been working on in the past 6 months. So after the town purchased the Irvine-Todaro property, we realized we needed to examine the possibility of gaining an easement just in case the trail decided to travel along the east side of Route 85. So we worked with the school officials and the planning board to gain an easement around the perimeter of the new school property. With that new development, we also hired the VHB engineering firm to look at two separate areas that we needed to pull out and look at. So we were at the point where we needed to provide a cost estimate, because we need to have that estimate if we're going to apply for state funds. And we needed to start to identify various different possibilities using town-owned properties along both sides of Route 85. We really have to figure out how we're going to do this. Next. So that brings us up, and this just slide just quickly mentions all of the different criteria that the engineers have to follow when we build out for this trail to maximize our opportunities to get the most funding. Next slide. So we came up with three possibilities to begin with, just to begin with. And with such a complicated project, we had to think about how we are going to connect all these various parcels together. So while the center trail is the nucleus where we have to start to analyze other segments, both east and the west sides of Route 85 to get to Milford. So over the past few years or so, the town actually has accumulated large parcels of land that we could actually tie into this trail system. So we encouraged the VHB to, and we gave them these various parcels to help study to see if we can make these parcels possible for a trail. Next stage, next page. So let me take you through the potential segments of parcels that could accommodate a Class 5 trail system. So the route on this map starts at the green circle and travels along the pink line and ends at the yellow circle. This leg starts at EMC Park, crosses Route 85, then enters the school complex, where it would connect to an abandoned railroad bed. Then it would travel north to connect to the center trail. Next slide. So this leg has some exciting possibilities because it would tie in the new elementary school to the EMC Park. It would cross the road close to the Hopkinton Center for the Arts. Then it would travel through the woods using the abandoned railroad bed onto the school grounds, where it would connect to the center trail. Next slide. So in this route, you will start with the green circle at EMC complex right at the border of the new elementary school. Then following the pink line, it travels around the perimeter of the new school, continuing south through the Totaro property, and ends at the Route 85 on the east side at the yellow circle. So the committee members worked with the Irvine-Todaro study group to ensure that a shared use parking space with the buses somehow could be provided for a trailhead parking area. Now, a trail this size must provide adequate parking. That's essential for the users. So if this need is neglected, it would cause users to park along the sides of the roads throughout various streets and neighborhoods, resulting in increased nuisance factors and unsafe parking situations. A Milford survey shows an equal amount of bikers and pedestrians can number up to 2,000 users on a good weekend day. Next slide. So it is important to note that if this option is not chosen, other trailhead option on the Route 85 west side will have to be identified. We would miss out on the opportunity to tie in all of the schools along the Hayden Road complex, and we would miss the opportunity to connect the EMC Field complex with the Hopkinton Center for the Arts. Next slide. So this map starts in the back of the existing center school by the common. So starting at the green circle in the back of the school, follow the yellow line that traverses through the woods and down a very large hill and ends in the southeast area of the Prestwick Drive area. The yellow circle is in close proximity to newly acquired town property that could possibly function as a secondary trailhead parking area. Next slide. So this natural geography on this hill behind the center school is just beautiful. It's unique, and it's a unique opportunity to incorporate a trail that would get us closer to Legacy Farms in Ashland. Again, keeping connectivity as the goal to increase our potential funding. Next slide. Now that you hopefully have a better understanding of what a Class 5 trail is, you probably want to know, how are we going to connect these various parcels? And what is it going to cost and how long will it take? So let me share with you some of our committee's works and vision. Next slide.
Jane, how are you doing on time?
Pretty good. Please note that unlike the previous slides, this map is conceptual only. Its distance is 2.2 as the crow flies, and this area will be divided up into different parcels using town-owned land. This map, next phase, overall approach. This map shows the breakout from the Milford bike trail, and the committee has already mapped out multiple options on the trail for both sides of Route 85, east and west. Next slide. Although a trail like this could cost around $1 million per mile, it is not unlike what other towns have paid for similarly constructed trails of this nature. The committee is working hard to find ways to maximize the amount of funding that we can receive, which could be up to 90% of the construction cost. We are also looking for creative ways to fund the remaining 10%. And we continue to work to determine the best trail options for the community at the lowest possible cost for the taxpayers. Next slide. So this is conceptual time frame. So how long would it take? Essentially, what we're showing you here is that it is possible to have a state-of-the-art trail completely built from Milford to Ashland in 8 to 10 years. And before that, we have to make sure that we are perfectly in line for the maximum amount of funding. So, in summary, our committee has been working 4 years now. We've been hard at work. We've identified our goals and priorities, which include building a multi-use trail, following all engineering and sound practices. We want to tie in town facilities and businesses. We want to seek approval from the Board of Selectmen. Our goal is to make it as little or as no cost to the taxpayers, and we want it to be embraced by the citizens. So tonight we've shown you some great maps and impressive data. However, this is just the beginning, and we will keep you posted on our progress. Next slide. So before we get to the questions, I should tell everyone that this presentation, along with supporting documentation, will be posted on our website. Thank you.
Excellent. You were spot on with your time. Well done.
Told you.
Thank you. And I appreciate you going through that quickly. I know you did. You did a great job. The center trail is a Class 4 trail.
Correct.
Correct. And are we trying to match that, or are we trying to go to, or are we trying to go to Class 5? Do we have to go to Class 5, or are we just
to receive the maximum amount of high priority funding from the state? The trail has to meet full accessibility. So Center Trail has the potential to become a Class 5 full accessibility if you want to maximize that opportunity. If we included that and had lesser quality trails, we would not have the same, we would not have the opportunity to get that funding from the state.
Got it. I've run on the Center Trail. I love running on the Center Trail, and I've run on the Milford Trail, and I love running down there too. It's a different experience though. I mean, you know, just the blacktop and the lines and everything, but I get the accessibility here is much better, and it's much easier for other types to move, you know, different people to move around depending on how they get around. So I think there's a great argument for both. So keeping to our process that we've all agreed to, great presentation. Thank you, Jane, and thank you to the entire committee. You guys have done a great job here. You've done a lot of work. We know that. We know that it's gotten a little bit tense in recent weeks or months because some things are kind of coming to a head. But that doesn't negate the work you've done at all by any means, and thank you all for that work. Mr. Sestari, any questions for Mrs. Moran?
Jane, thanks a lot to you and the committee. As Mr. Hurst said, it's a fantastic presentation. It's nice to see, you know, in greater detail what's happening and some of the plans that are being considered. You know, I guess I know that as we're moving forward, I would love to see some of the things that you put up there, some of the plans for the trails. I'd like to have the opportunity to see those and look at them in greater detail. Mm-hmm. One question I have for you. I know that there was some concern around the trails and, you know, some incidences that happened in neighboring towns where there were some crimes committed on the trails, and just discussing the some of the dangers that could be on the trails if they're going through neighborhoods and things mm-hmm. of that nature. Do we have that same concern of those same dangers if they're going right by our schools?
No, we would work closely with the schools to make sure that they felt comfortable with whatever trail safety measures that we needed to take, be it fencing or whatever it was. If you notice in Milford, they have full chain link fencing behind as the trail goes through there near their schools.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
That would be fully incorporated into the plan.
Mrs. Wright.
Just one other note on the class 4 versus class 5. I agree it's two very different experiences. You know, I think the class 5 does open a lot more options for people and their use. Sure. It makes it a little bit more accessible to families and whatever, rollerbladers or whatever.
Yeah, another great one like class 5 is the rail trail.
I mean, correct.
Most of us have probably been on the rail trail at some point in our lives, and that's an awesome place to go, you know, run or ride a bike or whatever. Mrs. Wright.
Yeah, no, thank you, Jane, for a ton of work and an excellent presentation, and I got to hand it to you because I was looking at these property maps and it felt like I was just banging my head against a wall and felt like you can't get there from here. So it's remarkable that you've been able to find some solutions. And to your point, Mr. Herr, about the rail trail, I mean, we've got all kinds of traffic concerns, larger traffic concerns in the town, and our roadways are getting less and less safe, so I don't know quite, you know, where the right answer lies, but I certainly know that in some of these trails, like the rail trail, there is a portion that you go onto a roadway if there's a way to make that connection safe.
One of a safe connection is our high priority.
But sometimes you have to do that. I just wanted clarification from you when you said the class 5, the highest grade, would allow possibly the maximum funding, but a class 4 or the crushed stone, a lower level, does that mean there would be no other funding or just less?
I can't answer that. I just know that the information that we've received is that if you follow the guidelines for a fully accessible class 5 trail, you have a high priority accessibility. You go to the top of the list for getting that funding. We don't have enough information to answer that question right now.
I mean, maximum is great, but it would be worth knowing if for some whatever reason, all things considered, we were to look for a proportion that was at the second tier. Are we talking zero funding, or would there be anything at all? I'm seeing Mr. Goldman shaking his head in the background, but okay. I like that for, you know, future information.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Good for now?
That's it. Yeah.
Mr. Catino.
Yeah, one of the things that's always been concerning me is the difference between the classes. Well, I've been on the committee since its inception, and I remember buying the first pieces of land, saying, "Okay, we got this one thing. What are we going to do with it? We'll get another one over here. Well, we got one more over here. Well, then how are we going to connect these? I don't know. We'll keep working on. Let's just buy another one. We'll get another one." And you know, for years it was, you know, how to find the pieces to do the charge of the Board of Selectmen. That was back when I was on the planning board. And it was always a great board to be on because we were making trails. We were going to try and hook up the towns. And for us to be in the middle, you know, the other towns looking at us saying, "All right, come on, we want to cut through you guys in order to get to the other one." But the my concern comes also between the Class 4 and the Class 5. Class 5 are great for young kids on bikes and because they're nice and flat and everything else, but in a hot summer day, you can't walk your dog on a Class 5 trail. Their paws get real hot, and they're really, really hot trails. You know, and I really, you know, I think of our town as more of a, the class four type trail, even though it is, as to Ms. Wright's point, that we may not get as much money, but it just has a better look and feel. It's not that cityscape kind of thing. Mm-hmm. But that's just my personal opinion. But I just, you know, I appreciate the presentation. It really brings, you know, because this is stuff that many of us see a lot of the times, and I get the minutes from you guys whenever I miss the meetings. But thanks for bringing this to everybody's attention so we can get an overview.
You miss the meetings?
Well, sometimes I join Zach, and I chair Zach, so I have to go
It's
to
actually
Zach.
At the same night as Zach, yeah. I think.
I'm kidding. Mr. Tedstone, going last this time.
All right.
Not fine. First.
So, Jane, that was an excellent presentation.
Thank you.
Obviously, a ton of work put into that. Some of the questions that I have is, and I don't know if this is the place to raise these questions or not, the railroad bed, it says it runs over 50 properties. Are those properties that it runs over, are they lawns, are they driveways, are they backyards, or is it woods? Like I see I see by the Remby, the old Remby property, I see there's a shed.
Correct.
Where the bridge is missing. And is it...
It's hard to determine, but there are a few sheds, and these people own this property.
Yeah.
And what we're trying to avoid is eminent domain issues.
Yeah.
I don't think we should go there. As a committee, we felt that we didn't want to go down that road. So we thought that in the past 10 years, the town has acquired large parcels of land. Mm-hmm. And if we can look at those large properties and figure out how we can connect them, we felt as a committee that would be the best way to go.
Okay. And then the other, as you were reading it, about the reimbursement rate of the class 5 versus the class 4, it always pops into my mind, I'm kind of a numbers person, where if we're getting 90% and that trail, the class 5 will cost us $1 million a mile, or if we get 80% and the class 4 costs us $750,000 a mile, it's kind of a wash. And I'm just throwing, you know, just round numbers out there. So before you can make that determination, you need to know apples and apples. And I know that you don't have
have that information right now.
Yep, but that would be pertinent to a final decision.
I do want, Mr. Chair.
Sure.
I do have a possible solution for this situation, but you don't have to hear it now, maybe after your discussion.
Yeah, let's keep going. We'll come back to that. So the rail trail crosses 50 properties, you mentioned.
Yes.
Is there an easement on those properties for this rail trail?
Yes.
Anywhere? Or is the rail trail is it contiguous throughout all 50 properties?
Yes. What happened was...
But is the easement contiguous along those properties? Okay.
It's
I mean, I have an easement in my backyard for a water line, and every now and then they go walking down through there.
That's what the easements are. They're perpendicular from maybe Route 85 through somebody's, between two properties to the railroad bed.
Not the lengthwise.
No.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. So, and I think Mr. Catino mentioned it, you know, the Milford Trail that we've all seen kind of come to be in the last 5 or 10 years is a great trail. And Milford put it in, but I think a lot of people in Hopkinton just saw that paved trail go in. In Hopkinton, what are we used to? We are used to class 4 or class 3s. I'm not opposed to the class 5 because I think it gives great access to people that wouldn't otherwise use trails or couldn't use trails. And I think we need to be as fair and open and easy to do to access the trail as possible. But our community is used to class 4 and class 3. The trails below my house are, I love going to the top of the mountain and skiing, and I love going to the trails in Upton State Forest over there. It just brings me great joy running back in there, and I've seen some people in the room tonight running back in there. But those are not class 5 trails at all. I mean, those are dangerous at times, which is part of the fun, kind of. But if we go to class 5, I think everybody in the room and a lot of people in town have to recognize that's going to be a big change for Hopkinton, okay? And when you try to propose a big change anywhere, work, home, whatever, you get a lot of resistance. Okay, so if we want to go the Class 5 route, let's be honest, that's going to be a big change for our perception of the trail network in Hopkinton, Massachusetts. I'm not against it. I think in many ways it makes a lot of sense. But, you know, with that effort, with needs to be an understanding that that's going to be hard for a lot of people to swallow. That's a big change. It's one thing to run on pine bed trails, you know, pine leaves or whatever, needles on the trails. It's another thing to run on or walk on or bike on or whatever, the Milford Trail, which I love too, but they're different experiences, as Mr. Sestari and I said. So we can't be naive about this. If we're going Class 5 and we can all come to some consensus about why that makes sense, great. But we have to understand that outside this room, there's 16,795 other people, and about 15,000 are going to have an opinion about these things. And yours truly, we're going to hear it. So the Class 5 is a big step up, I think, for the community and what we're used to. With that, and sticking to the process, any other sort of initial thoughts, questions? So we have two other topics, and I just want to refresh my memory and everyone else's for that matter, because I forgot. Were we going to go get some input now, or are we going to go look at these other two and then try and get some input?
The other two.
Yeah, I think we're going to have a quick discussion about the other two here. And then we'll kind of come out to some public input. Mr. Catino.
Yeah, I just have one quick one. I don't want people to think that it has to be an either or. Like we were just talking about, you know, having a spur go from the center trail to EMC the EMC Park or EMC Park to the schools, or go, you know, an east side or a west side. You know, I think that we should always keep our options open, because we want to connect all of our schools and, you know, all of our businesses if possible. You know, I think that was one of the things that we always, you know, when we did the Conway report, we had this trail network and spurs going all over the place, along with the major one of connecting Ashland, Hopkinton, and Milford.
Just through the chair.
Sure.
It's your choice, obviously, but it's for our committee, it came down to the funding. And if we can get this to little or no cost, it would have to be a Class 5. And I do have a solution that I could suggest. I'm not sure if you're ready for it now.
Yeah, let us dive into a couple of these other topics, and we'll come back to that when we come to sort of public input. Okay. So we have two other topics specific to the Trails Committee that we want to do at the board level here. And I think they're a little almost out of order. It's like, you know, we need to think about the charge of the committee and the good work they've done, and maybe do we want to address that charge in any way. It's not an advisory committee. It is a full-blown appointed committee with spending authority and decision-making authority, obviously specific to spending. And then sort of right behind that is then we have the makeup of the committee and the members on the committee, all great human beings who happen to live in places where this is problematic from the State Ethics Commission's perspective, or possibly from the State Ethics Commission's perspective. So I don't know how we want to tackle this, but any thoughts on the charge and then maybe the membership, or I mean, we kind of do them. I think we're going to do them together. So just throw it up to the board. Any ideas, any comments? Mr. Catino.
No, it's hard for me. I'm on the committee, so you know I'm in a difficult position because I think for almost five years we've been plodding along, buying stuff. You know, everybody in a great mood, trying to just move ahead, and it just seems that recently it's gotten tough. Just when we think we're doing some great stuff, all of a sudden it got scary to be on the board. You know, it hasn't been as much fun.
Okay. What do you mean scary? Like,
well, people voicing their opinions, and there's a lot of I love passion. That's what gets everybody to be on boards and run for office. It's a very scary thing, running for office, but it takes passion. But sometimes some of the passions have been somewhat over the top at some meetings, and many people have been at some of these meetings. And
on both sides.
Okay. Anybody else have any initial thoughts about charge or membership and the forms and all that stuff?
Well, you know, reading over the charge of the committee, it talks about doing the very things that I think are healthy and inclusive and what this town, as a rule, wants in any good planning, which, as it says, involves extensive community input, openness, inclusion, including stakeholders, collaboration. You know, this is these are all the hallmarks of good, inclusive planning that is not top-down, which this town never wants. And, you know, as I said, when I was looking at the property maps and felt like I was banging my head against a wall because, you know, not only, as Jane mentioned a few meetings back, you know, she might be in a butter. We don't know where this trail is going to go. When you looked at these property maps, the conundrum is that the town has been so built out. If we'd thought of this 30, 40 years ago, when that land wasn't developed, we'd have been in a different place. But, you know, you can't have those years back. We're here where we are. And almost every way you turn, you're going to be going through somebody's neighborhood or near somebody's property. So, you know, to try to avoid the inclusion of those inputs is A, impossible, and B, I don't think it's good community planning. I think this is a healthy charge. The issue is how do you balance the conflict of interest issues with taking those very valuable concerns, giving them a seat at the table. So I think looking at this charge that it's still a healthy charge. The issue is addressing maybe who was on the committee at what point.
How about in terms of location? I mean, I think when we last met and discussed this issue, what came up specific to the concept or the, you know, the idea of is the charge for the committee right, was the location of the trails and where the work, where the energy of the committee was being directed at that time and perhaps to this day. I think that's what I was considering when I was considering the charge. I think the other stuff that you've outlined there that is in the charge, that's fairly standard in all of them, and I think that's all happening. I mean, it's happening. There are a lot of people are here, so obviously they're reaching out, and people know what's going on, so that's all good. And the fact that we have some energy in this issue right now is not surprising at all. I mean, we talk about it all the time. There's three things that happen at Hopkinton where you get a lot of energy: trails, trash, and
taxes.
Not taxes. Believe it or not, what's the other one? No, it's a T. Trails.
Trees.
I'm sorry, I couldn't believe it. Trees. Trails, trash, and trees. They are the three things that will get this community more energized than anything else, more so than your tax bill, except for a couple of people I know, and more so than even the schools are those three things, trails, trash, and trees.
And charter.
So, I'm sorry?
And the charter,
which we're going to find out about next week. So, but I thought that was one of the charge questions that we were talking about a couple weeks ago. Is there any interest, or does the committee, or does the board feel that that piece of the charge has to be addressed, or are we okay leaving that open at this time?
I'm fine with it. Oh.
Yeah, I mean, I guess earlier I thought that we were just kind of trying to figure out how to attack this, whether we go BC or CB. But, you know, while we're talking about the charge, I guess I'm looking at the suggested changes, and I mean, to me they seem pretty minimal. So I'm seeing that we switch out the collaboration, you know, from the town government side, from planning and permitting to someone from town operations. I'm wondering what effect do we think that is going to have on all of this?
I'd have to direct that to Mr. Kamalo, who was in conference when you were speaking there.
Yeah, Mr. Kamalo, yes. I'm trying to figure out these changes and what effect we think that they'll have. And one of them is swapping out planning and permitting representation and collaboration to town operations. Can you explain what we're trying to achieve there?
Yes. I'll answer the questions directly and then address a general issue regarding the changes that I indicated in the draft charge. The first change relative to collaboratively, that's purely grammatic. We already have the language collaborative. We're changing that to collaboratively. Yeah. And then the next change with regards to the Director of Land Use Planning and Permitting, it's reflecting the change in the title of Elaine Lazarus.
Okay.
So specifically with regard to those two questions.
So it's not a change in the actual person who's going to be involved. It's just change in the title.
The title, okay. Correct. Yes. And then in terms of the scope of the changes, unfortunately, the version that you're looking at only captures a portion of the changes that are proposed. And with that in mind, and with the chair's permission, we can have Elaine walk us through the specific changes. They are two conceptual changes that I think the board needs to be aware of. The first one relates to the committee, whether the committee is making the final decisions or is advisory. That change apparently was not captured in our track changes document. The other change that is substantive is the membership of the committee. The change that we want to indicate reflects both the organic evolution in the committee that has happened over the recent past, as well as what we're proposing as an option going forward.
Okay. I'd like to hear those.
Yeah.
I also have a couple of comments on this. So regarding the composition of the committee, one thing I see here is we're striking the designee of open space. Mm-hmm. Can you just explain that, why the suggestion?
Yes, in fact, this is one of the evolutionary changes. It's a change that was brought to the board's attention several months ago. The board acted on it, made the change on the ground in terms of the membership of the committee, but did not make the written change. So we're simply reflecting what has happened on the ground. This is administrative.
So that was something that happened without the charge actually being changed.
Exactly. It's purely housekeeping.
You could look at it that way, or you could look at it that they want a different direction from what the charge said. And now we're trying to make the charge match what happened.
Yes. In fact, it was the vote of the Board of Selectmen.
I don't recall that.
It was.
Okay. That's fine.
Some time back.
I don't remember everything.
Issue, to explain to the public, the issue then was that several attempts were made to designate a representative of the Open Space and Preservation Committee. That representation wasn't forthcoming. And there was work to be done.
You need help.
Exactly. There was work to be done.
That's fine.
Yes. Yeah.
The other observation I have, and I guess suggestion, and you know, I know that back in was 2011 when the charge was originally put together, there was discussion about the composition of the committee. But you know, as the work has evolved, as it's been stated a couple of times here, you know, we don't necessarily know where the trail is going. We don't know who's in a butter and who's not. And I guess my suggestion to what I'm seeing here is, we strike the two abutters or residents in the area or vicinity of the proposed trail, and we make it six members at large. And then if there is a vote that that causes somebody to be in a butter, so if there are votes regarding a trail that's going by someone's house or in their vicinity, then that person needs to recuse themselves. Mm-hmm.
Well, if we had abutters intentionally on the committee and then the board voted to accept some Mass General Law Ethics Commission form that allows them to be on it as abutters and fully participate, we could do that. So we would have abutters voting, But we wouldn't have four or five. Yeah, we'd have
what I'm saying,
two.
Though, is you don't necessarily know who's going to be in a butter for any particular vote or any spur of the trail.
Yeah, I got you. Well, Mrs. Wright.
To Mr. Sestari's point, I as well think that the inclusion of certainly a butters is looking for trouble. If for no other reason than the appearance of impropriety. But this says abutters or residents in the area in the vicinity. And I do think back to the idea of a well-comprised committee that includes stakeholders and gets the opinions and the viewpoints mm-hmm. of stakeholders. It is good to have, abutters is different than residents in the vicinity. People that are in the vicinity and perhaps as the location becomes, you get down from that 50,000 foot view down to closer to the ground and you're talking about specific parcels, perhaps there be a provision that if one of those members becomes a direct abutter, then they must recuse themselves or be replaced. I noticed there was one individual that submitted one of the forms about financial interest who is a direct abutter and another person who's over 2,000 feet away. Like when you do public hearing notice notifications, what is it, 300 feet, is it?
300.
Yeah, there's a certain limit that's sort of generally considered that you might realistically have a financial interest and beyond that, well, maybe not. So I think that finding a middle ground between including people that understand the area and not the conflict of being a direct abutter should be found and can be found.
Okay. Anybody else? Thoughts on the charge? So in general, Mr. Tenstow, you're generally good with the charge as is today.
I am. That's correct.
In general.
Okay. In general.
Mr. Catino, in general?
In general.
Okay. What are your thoughts about this abutter concern or discussion?
Well, it never seemed to come up in the last 4 or 5 years. We'd be buying properties near somebody, and the stuff never came up. But I think that just when we decided that, we're almost there, that we can start connecting, that all of a sudden that people came out that may not have been abutters, that may have bought a piece of land here, but now there's the abutters are now in between where we want to do the connection. It came up. So, and it's great, it's important to have opinions from everybody. But it's also important to have real information. I don't think it's fair to have people think that there's going to be a 16-foot asphalt road, for lack of a better term, going through somebody's neighborhood. That was never an intention. It was never the intention of the Board of Selectmen when they gave us the charge to attach these. Some of the rhetoric that's been out there would have frightened me. Now, I'm one of those people, and I've mentioned it, everybody knows, I love trails. I'd love to have a trail up in our area, but we're on the other side of 495. And I don't think we won't get one for years. Like, this is, 2019? We're probably about 2029 by the time that we get hooked up. But that being said, it would scare anybody to think that there was a big asphalt runway coming through the neighborhood. And that's why I'm really for a less class trail. But it was never to go through anybody's neighborhood. And I don't want anybody to think that anything's going to go through anybody's neighborhood.
Well,
it's going to have to go around neighborhoods because the neighborhoods are there.
That's we got an email recently, and that's, what is your definition of through the neighborhood?
Right.
Okay, so I could say there's a water pipe running through my backyard. Well, it's in the woods in my backyard, and I'd have to go dig it up to find it, but it's there. What is your definition of through the neighborhood? Through the neighborhood is, I see, right down through the neighborhood, like right between people's houses and right on the road and between the next house across. That's through the, in my head anyway. But that's a perception thing. Everybody has a different definition of through the neighborhood. Some people are saying if the trail's around the neighborhood, behind the houses, all the way around, that's through the neighborhood. So it depends on how people look and feel. The issue is, I think, you get into semantics about definitions. I don't want to get into what the definition is, but that's kind of what we're talking about. But I want to try and move this forward. It's 8:35. I don't see us sort of making decisions tonight to change the whole world here. I don't see us necessarily making decisions at all, perhaps, if we give the public an opportunity to say hello and weigh in a little bit. But I do want to kind of give us some, try to get some direction about where we're headed. Mr. Sestar.
I'm just seeing that under the composition, it says that the committee shall consist of at least 9 full-time members, full members. Is that how we put it out there for all committees, at least a number? Because this tells me that if we want to have 12, 13, 14, we could.
At the time the charge was put together, there was an anticipation that the workload was going to be substantial. And I think that's why
we have 11.
Yeah.
You do have 11 now?
We have 11. We have two associate non-voting members who actually work very, very hard, providing data collection and research.
Okay, but they wouldn't be considered full members, though, because they're...
No, they don't vote, but right. They are there. And the purpose is because people move, people change, they resign. And so when we need to fill that slot, we have somebody ready, up to speed, ready to fill in.
Oh, yeah, and I'm good with that. Yeah. I'm just,
so we have
just
9 full and 2 associate.
Saying at least 9 members is a little bit odd.
No, we keep everybody busy.
We could probably tighten that up. And say it's 9 members and 2 alternates or something like
that. Yeah, exactly.
We can tighten that up. Because if we're going to do, I think to Mrs. Wright's point, if we're going to tighten up the language specific to abutters, okay, we should probably tighten up the number of members and the alternates, and because everybody would have to play by those rules, and just I think that sort of stuff makes sense. So we want to probably note that from tonight too. Okay. Okay. So. And just, you know, we've gotten some emails from some folks specific to the legal stuff here and am I going to jail and all that kind of stuff. Nobody's going to jail if they're in a butter to this trail. Nobody's going to jail. Nobody's getting fined. Well, the town is very actively trying to address the issue, so nobody in Boston's going to come out here and raise heck. That said, there are people in town that are ready to write letters to the State Ethics Commission, okay? And there are more than you think ready to write letters to the State Ethics Commission. A lot of people love to stir the pot and never tell anybody they're doing it. We've figured that out over the years. So we're trying to, those of you who think that we're kind of getting on you about whether you're a butter or not, we're trying to help you here, believe it or not. I know you're passionate about the trail, but if you are in a butter to a piece of land that's currently under debate for whatever reason about where the trails might go, and others see that opportunity to stir the pot, they're going to do it. So let us work through this abutter thing, and please don't take it personally. It is designed to protect the individuals, and it's designed to protect the town. But anything and everything we've done to date, there is no issue. So just hang in there with us. So what I would suggest we do now is I think we've got a feel for kind of the charge. I don't see a huge groundswell here on the board to change the charge dramatically. I think we want to tighten up some of the language. And I think we want to look at the number of members, and I think we do need to look at this abutters thing. Specific to the conflict of interest disclosure forms, we would take action on that after we tighten up this other stuff, Mr. Camallo, and vote to change the charge administratively, correct? Because we wouldn't do that. There's no point in doing that until we understand exactly what we're going to do with abutters, correct?
That is correct. In other words, you understand how the committee is going to work going forward. And then you have the definition, use that as your definition of the four corners as to
whether or not we'd have to do that. Exactly. We may not even have to do that going forward. Yeah. Mr. Catino.
Yeah, if we on the Upper Charles Board become an advisory board, how does that change? If Mr. Camallo, you could define, because doesn't that just, makes the Section B moot at that point? We don't even have to look at that.
So as an advisory board, you do a lot of work, but you can't make final decisions, and you don't have the authority to spend any money. I'm not inclined to go advisory board route. I don't think that really helps the process move along. I think if we take care of a couple of the other concerns, then I don't think we need to go advisory board. We've got great volunteers in town working really hard on this issue. Let's keep working the issue. That doesn't mean we're not going to have a few more emails sent our way, and that doesn't mean there's not going to be a few more papers, articles going in the newspaper. Which, while some feel good doing that, that doesn't always help the cause, just an FYI. from a political standpoint, having been around a little bit here. But I don't think advisory really makes sense. Does anybody feel strongly one way or the other?
No, I agree. I think that, you know, specifically around the conflict of interest area, if we can take care of that, then there really shouldn't be any other concern. Because right. In the end, it all comes to town meeting anyway,
right.
To spend that money. But
okay. Have you ever had any trouble with all the pieces of land we bought so far? We haven't had any trouble at town meeting. And that's why I was just so surprised at the passion, because you know every town meeting we go to, people say, "You're putting trails? Great. How much is it? Fine." And we, you know, it was always unanimous to buy trails, land for trails.
Yep. Okay, Mrs. Wright.
Just one quick thing that we might want to consider looking at the charge. We're talking about tightening it up, but I thought one thing that might loosen it up might just kind of broaden our scope is that it says very specifically, and which trail shall incorporate the Hopkinton Center Trail, which is still, I think, an objective, but who knows? I mean, maybe that... working through the Trudaro and into some of the school properties and out to East Main, that there is a certain restriction with specifying it must incorporate the center trail, that would it be wise to just loosen that a little bit to say ideally or something, just know that so that the committee is not totally, totally locked into any one piece. I don't know.
I don't think we have a problem with
hang on one sec, please. So, and that's where I got my initial understanding of what the charge was that center trail piece. And that's why I got my little brain here, the west side, 85, center trail, kind of straight line down, rail trail, easements, things like that.
Could it turn into a stumbling block? I don't know.
Yeah. Well, that's why...
why do that to ourselves?
I would prefer to leave it in, but leave the charge, not make it advisory, leave the charge, leave the responsibility and authority with the Trails Committee to sort it out. And I'm sure we're going to have a few more debates in town about how we do this going forward, but I wouldn't want to pull that away. Yeah, I wouldn't want to pull that out, nor would I want to pull away their authority and make them advisory. So
I wasn't looking to pull it out as much as just add a softener, like ideally, or something that... should they find some other alternative that really makes sense all around, that for whatever left the center trail as a standalone, that might just be an option on the table, just not to hem us in any direction where everything is so open right now.
Okay.
Doesn't have to be.
So again, I don't see us really coming to hard resolutions tonight or hard decisions tonight. I think it's been a good discussion so far. What I'd like to do is give the public an opportunity. So you see, we have a time crunch, folks, and it always goes longer than we think. And while we're not by law obligated to come to the public now, even though it's a public meeting, that's a public hearing, by the way. If you do a public hearing, we have to have public input. But for this, we don't, but I'd like to, because I think there's a lot of folks here with some good ideas and good energy. So we're going to spend a few minutes doing that now, and then we'll table this and bring it back again here in a future meeting and kind of keep working the process. Does that sound fair to everybody in terms of decision-making? Everybody okay with that?
Yeah, and if we start hearing the same themes going from one speaker to the next, maybe we can just get a show of hands and all the people who support that.
Yeah. So with that very good point, we're going to ask anyone from the public that wants to say hello to come up and say hello. You got to come up and just stand behind Jane. Again, 2 minutes, please. And when we start to repeat ourselves or if the person in front of you has already said what you want to say, just turn around and go back and sit down. It's just like town meeting. We want to do this in about 10 minutes and then we're going to put a wrap on it. So 2 minutes, please. Mr. Goldman, you'll go first.
Dave Goldman, President of Hopkinton Area Land Trust. I'd like to put a few facts on the table for the selectmen to consider. Number one, Center Trail is a trail that goes from Main Street to Chamberlain Street, not just Main Street to the Loop Road. There is a full trail there, Class 4. Number two, the school property where that trail exists is governed by a conservation restriction. Conservation restriction would make it hard to put a Class 5 trail anywhere on the property. Three, there are several pieces of property that the town owns that was purchased with CPC funds, which require conservation restrictions. The land trust is in negotiation with the town for conservation restrictions on four or five properties that have been concluded with CPC funding, including extending the trail, the center trail, which we do not cover, from Main Street 1,200 feet down the trail. That will be covered by a conservation restriction in the future. We hope that's part of the negotiations. Any one of these properties, if used for rail trail, like the Wyckoff property, if it has a conservation restriction, it will allow trails, but not Class 5. My 2 minutes.
Okay, and there are a lot of CRs out there and a lot of CRs pending. That is a very consistent, that's not only a Hopkinton thing, that's consistent across the Commonwealth. Excellent points, thank you. Anyone else like to say hello? Share some ideas. Chief Emeritus.
Good evening. Thank you, Mr. Chair, for allowing us to speak. I am an abutter, so that's out and clear to the Echo Trail part of the trail system. So I have some personal concerns, as well as being a user of the trail system, both the Center Trail in town, as well as other trails, and the Milford Trail. I think one of the things I wanted to see, if the board wasn't aware, is I've attended several of the committee meetings on the Trails Committee, and what I've seen is a very conscientious committee working through several issues and trying to come up with the best proposal to present to the town. If they're focused on what type of trails that the town is going to want and proposing that so that the town can make a decision on that. So I think that's one of the first things the town people have to do is make that decision about what type of trails they want. Is it a Class 5 trail? Because what I always hear is we want to be like Milford. We want to be like the Milford Trail. Well, if that's the case, from what Dave just said, that may not be possible and we have to look at something else. But the first thing you need to do is identify that before you can even go to the next stage of this process, because there's no sense preparing for a Class 5 trail if it's not going to be allowed. And if it's going to be a Class 4 trail, you want it to be as accessible as possible, because we want this to be a trail that can be used by everybody, not just by the people who like to run. You got to have the accessibility to the mothers with the baby strollers, like my wife was just very short time ago, to the toddlers, to now my 9 and 10-year-olds that are on the trail with their dog all the time. So I think it's very important that be something that is discussed, allowed to be flushed out, and a presentation made to the board so you guys can make the decision. One of the big things is safety to me. It's always been part of my prior career. It's always been safety of on the roads, pedestrians, and things like that. I think one of the things I've seen the board also do is spend time very worried about where these trails are going to cross and making sure they're at the right grade, they have the right sight distance, or they're going to be, or they're going to be doing some sort of structure that's going to allow for that to happen. So I think that's the other thing that really needs to be flushed out. And I know that that's something they've been very concerned about. So I think as much as possible, to allow the committee to go ahead as they've been charged is the proper step for the townspeople so that we get a usable and accessible trail for everybody.
Great.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Mr. LeGoy.
So I think quick correction. I'm not sure that this is actually a Class 4. What we're talking about is the difference between a Class 4 trail and a Class 5. As Jane said, a class five can be a stone dust trail. Center Trail was engineered, designed for two-way traffic. The difference comes into accessibility, whether it's ADA accessible. And the Center Trail is designed to be an accessible trail. So in my opinion, it is a Class 5 trail. It's a stone dust Class 5 trail. I think that's, so the question is whether it's asphalt versus stone dust. And then my other point is that with a lot of these things, you know, at the level you guys are seeing it, it's great, but the devil's in the details. My concerns on some of the work that I've seen, and the committee has certainly done a great job. They put a lot of effort into this. But, for example, we just had a kid hit crossing Chestnut Street. Moving the trail to the east side adds Chestnut Street into the mix, and I just don't think that's a smart move. Even when he got hit, the issue that we were that wasn't even involved there is glare. If you've gone that route sometimes, you just flat out can't see. So all the blinking lights in the world aren't going to protect you. And as a runner, if you look up and you see a car coming at you in the morning, you don't know that they can't see anything. And that's, I think, something that, to me, makes that route a non-starter. I do think that we need to kind of back up and look at all the routes, the possible routes, and then make a determination going forward. But I think we ought to, as was said here, try and use as much town land as possible. So thanks.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes, sir. If you wouldn't mind introducing yourself, please.
Yes, Stuart Henner, resident of the town for 10 years, member of the scouting community. In fact, my son on his Eagle Scout project worked in the town helping with the trails. So just two comments. One is, I think the connectedness nature of the trail is important. So as you consider the aspects that are important to Hopkinton and Hopkinton's community, how it connects to the other towns around us is very important. I know many members of the Milford, the Holliston, the Ashland communities that use the trails, and they very much enjoy traversing the town lines and participating in that community. And then two, I think having well-connected trails doesn't necessarily mean they have to be the same grade across the entire town. I think there can be various levels. So I think that's an important aspect just to consider. It doesn't need to be the same standard everywhere.
Great. Good feedback. Thank you. Anybody else? There's another hand up. Yes, sir.
Good evening. John Spinelli of Alexander Road. First and foremost, just thank the committee. This has been a challenge, to say the least, in town over the last several months. I've attended several meetings of the Upper Charles, some of the CPC meetings, and thank you for bringing this to the forefront, allowing people to come and speak, and just kind of getting this out in the open. I think at the beginning there was a lot of misinformation that went out there that caused some of the animosity between the sides of what was going on. I have to say, in my experience of dealing with Jane and the Upper Charles, the one thing that I've been very impressed about is that everything has been open. It's been on the table. There has been no clandestine about anything. She's invited multiple people from all over town to participate in her meetings, to participate in what's going on and give their viewpoint. So I hope that the town takes that into consideration and this board takes into consideration not to change her charter, because I think she's doing an excellent job. She's done more in 6 months as the chair than I think the committee's been able to accomplish in the last 3 or 4 years it's been around. I think that says a lot towards her character. It's unfortunate that over the last couple months, her character's been brought into question, and some of the other members of the board of the Upper Charles has been questioned. I can tell you, dealing with these people, that their character has been spectacular. They've been very welcoming and very opening, meeting on nights, weekends, phone calls, emails going back and forth, trying to find a way to make everybody happy. As you know, that's not going to happen. It's a challenge, to say the least. I think they're on the right path.
Excuse me.
And I think with this board's help, and with the help of the members of the community, they can stay on task and we can get a beautiful trail, whatever that may be, class 4 or class 5. So I'm really up here just in support of the committee, in support of their members. They're doing a great job. I really hope, I have seen some of you at the meetings, that we don't get sidetracked. And I think by you hearing everyone's viewpoints and hearing Jane's presentation, we can put that behind us, move forward, and find a common ground for everyone. That's really it.
Great. Thank you. Well said.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Everybody good? Yes, sir.
David Dahlenmeyer, Proctor Street. I just have a quick question. Do we have any kind of numbers about usage of the trails? Anything that's even halfway reliable?
We have some surveys from Milford that if I can share with you, if you leave me your email, okay. I can forward that.
Mr. Catino.
Yeah, one of the things, one of the misconceptions that is actually, if you saw in the presentation, that there was a peak day in Milford that there were 2,000 people on the trail. Now, granted, that was probably one day, mid-June, where it was absolutely 75 degrees and sunny. I don't believe that there that you know I don't know what the what our center trail has on a peak day, but I'm sure that it's not that there aren't going to be parades of people trying to walk on our class 3, class 4, class 5 stone dust trail on any given day. But that's one of the things I just wanted to put that out there because you know that's another number. You know, 16 feet wide of asphalt, 2,000 people walking by a neighborhood. I don't see it.
Okay, thank you. Anybody else have any other questions or comments? Anything they'd like to share? Any questions or concerns specific to the whole conflict of interest questionnaire, the forms, state ethics laws? You know, there's perceived conflicts of interest, which are you have to fill out a form for that too. Whether you're even if you don't have a conflict, you still got to do some stuff. So these all will come into play as we sort this out. But does anybody have any questions specific to that? Because we did get a few emails around that question or those concerns. Mr. Kamal, do you have any thoughts specific to what you've heard tonight and kind of where we are?
Yes, in terms of the last issue, if any member of the committee believes or recognizes that they have a potential or perceived conflict of interest, please call our office. We'll give you town council's number. There's also legal services available at the state level that we can also connect with you with. I do sense from Brian that there are several people who are concerned. Please, no. As early as tomorrow, call our office. We'll work with you in terms of how you address that issue.
Anything else? Okay, so if I think we've had a good conversation tonight, folks. Jane, great job as always. Committee members, thank you for your work. Those concerned on either side, thank you for your input tonight. Trees, trash, trails, they all stir the passions pretty much equally too, by the way. God forbid there's trash on the trails where someone cut down a tree because then all hell's going to break loose. But trees, trash, and trails, this is one of those issues that gets us going, and that's a good thing. We're going to figure this out. We're going to do it together. We're going to work on it. Jane's committee's going to work on it. All the volunteers are going to work on it. Those concerned about it are going to work on it. And if we all keep talking to each other and we all keep communicating with town manager's office, with Elaine Lazarus, with the committee itself, we're going to find a solution that works for everybody. Okay? We haven't found the solution yet. There's a solution out there. There's a solution to everything. We haven't found it yet. But if we yell at each other, we call each other names, and we get into this sort of Washington style of interaction, okay, that's not going to work. So in Hopkinton, we do best when we work together. We're all volunteers for the most part, and we can make this happen. So please hang in there with us. Please continue to work the issues, continue to talk to each other. But let's take the rhetoric down a couple of notches. Let's take the scare taxes down a couple of notches, because that, as I mentioned earlier, that does not help the cause. And we're going to find a solution that works for everybody, okay? So with that, we're going to end this discussion tonight and come back to it in a future meeting very soon. We'll let you know when that is, and certainly anybody can attend. Thank you all for coming.
Thank you. Thank you to the board.
Okay. So with that, and I apologize for us being behind schedule, but we're going to ramp it up speed-wise now. We're moving on to item number 7, which is the special town meeting. We have a special town meeting that starts on Monday, January 30th, and we have articles that we have already looked at for the most part in front of us tonight. Typically, the Board of Selectmen will sort of weigh in on the various articles in advance of town meeting, so that should the moderator, and I emphasize the word should the moderator ask what the Board of Selectmen's vote was on non-Board of Selectmen articles, we can have an answer for them, if you will. So with that, I'd like to kind of go through these fairly quickly, keeping in mind that we've already voted in some form or fashion on a couple of these already, okay? The first one, Mr. Kamalo, is, and I don't have my computer up and running at the moment. Thank you. Charter the first review. One is the charter review. Now, the Board of Selectmen a week or two back, or a meeting or two back, had an excellent presentation from a charter review chair, Pam Waxlex, who's here this evening. And at that time, she asked that the Board of Selectmen adopt a motion, which we did, to support the recommendations as presented by the Charter Review Committee. Okay? So, keeping in mind that at town meeting, it's likely that some of this is going to get dissected. I think that's a fair statement to make. Is the board still comfortable with that vote, and do we need to do anything else specific to Article 1 from your perspective as individual members?
I'm comfortable with it.
You good?
Yeah.
Mr. Catino? Good? Mrs. Wright?
Good to go.
Good. Mr. Sestari? Good. Okay, so with that, the chair will entertain a motion that the Board of Selectmen supports Article 1. No. Let me back up. Mr. Kamal, what do you think is the best way to... Do we need to even vote Article 1 again?
I think we already did.
Yes, the board already voted.
So we already voted Article 1. We supported the presentation as made by the Charter Review Committee. We're moving on. Everybody good? But if it comes up at town meeting, the answer was we voted 5-0, if I remember correctly.
Yep.
Okay. That's good. See, we're going to make up time here. Article 2. Article 2 is specific to the school, the new elementary school being built on Hayden Row, where, and I was fortunate to attend with the MSBA meeting with members of the Elementary School Building Committee, Mr. Shepherd, elementary school or the school committee itself, and others to discuss the situation. The board, I think everybody's aware, Mr. Tedstone clearly is aware, he's on the committee. We have a school we're building to 395 people today, students today, and the NESDEC numbers are showing not a spike, but an increase in enrollment in Hopkinton for years to come at the elementary pre-K through, well, K-1, I guess, is probably the numbers we looked at, K-1 numbers for years to come. And so at some point, we're going to be expanding that school. We could fill those classrooms next year if it was built next year. The thinking is we've got a contractor who hasn't poured concrete yet in that area. We've got a contractor that's taking down the trees. We've got a contractor that's putting in the driveway, on and on and on. If we do it now, we can do it right in line with what we're doing square footage-wise, et cetera. If we wait a couple of years, the numbers aren't going away. The NESDEC numbers aren't going away. We're going to need more classrooms. It's better to go now than later.
I think something to keep in mind, too, is that and we have plenty of people from the school committee who can correct me if I'm wrong, but the original application was for a larger number than what we were approved for. And, in fact, the MSBA knocked it down even further than where it is now. And Mr. Graziano went to the MSBA along with members from the school committee and got them to bump it up. And I'll say meet us in the middle, but they didn't quite get halfway to where we were originally. So this isn't a surprise to the school committee, and it shouldn't be a surprise to us either.
And it wasn't a surprise to the MSBA, who's to a person, I don't know, it was 10 or 12 of them sitting around a table, to a person, every one of them said, yeah, we get it. This isn't, you know, you guys aren't making this up. You're not just looking for whatever. We get it. You guys need to do this. We went to the MSBA, and I'm trying to do this fast, guys, to save everyone's time here tonight. So if I say something wrong, tell me. We went to the MSBA for two reasons. Let them know we're hoping to do this because we need to do this. And is it okay if we do this based on what you've already approved in the scope of the project to date, like the current project? And two, while we're here, hey, would you mind kicking in a little cash to help us out? Okay. So the answer on number two was no. Okay. The answer on number one was absolutely, we get it. You need to build a bigger school. We support you doing it now, but based on our procedures, it's not that they want to help, but their procedures and how they do everything and sort of the letter of the law and the funding, they couldn't do anything on the additional funds.
So the $1.5 million, is this the total actual cost?
So why don't we have somebody join us now and we'll walk through this.
Sure. So Mike wants to come up as well. So thank you. It's a great question. And Brian, thank you for the lead up. So my my comments here are going to be like 1/4 of what they were going to be now. So,
excellent.
The total cost of the project, this addition, would be $3.5 million. The project is currently running $2 million under budget. So one of the factors of timing here is that by doing this at special town meeting, it would allow us to utilize that $2 million difference on this project and only go up by an additional 1.5. So the ask is 1.5, but the total cost of the addition is 3.5.
Can I just ask in relation to that? I thought I had read that if we fund this now, that there was the possibility to go back to MSBA for some, no, this will all be on us.
Is it possible?
Henceforth.
Okay. This is it. The MSBA could have done three things, and they did one of them for us. They agreed that because of the numbers, they saw the same analysis from NASDAQ and says, yeah, something really strange is that. And we've heard this before. Mm-hmm. Something's really strange in Hopkinton, 495 Mass Pike, all that language. And that we see you need a bigger school. It was almost 4 years ago when we went back to them and they first analyzed the numbers. And as Brian said, we said we need a school this big. They said, no, we looked at all the numbers, it only has to be this big. Then we went back to them again, and they said, we never do this, but in your case, we'll give you 50 more students. So we signed the agreement. So the other thing that they could have done, and they did with a project I was involved in Brookline, is that if during the course of the project you find extra money, they won't let you spend that money because in their minds, if you have the extra money to do this, then you don't need money from us. So they could have said, no, we don't want you to do it. Wait till it's all done. What they did say was yes, we agree, and they agreed now is the time to do it. Not only did the MSBA and the planning board and all of us throughout this, when we designed the school, we designed it for up to 8 additional classrooms in one specific location. Mm. The whole school is designed around that. Mm. The MSBA did give us enough coverage for the cafeteria, the library space, school administration, the gymnasium, to cover this bigger school, knowing that someday we'd have to do it. Mm-hmm. but as John said and as Brian said, the numbers came in primarily because we got a really good contractor. We got a really good site contractor. We got a great architect. The numbers come in substantially lower than anybody expected, to the tune of $2 million. The committee did some fine-tuning with the numbers almost a year ago and eliminating things that we thought were, might be frivolous and that, you know, were in fact probably frivolous. We're not putting any of that stuff back in. It was never our intent. We were all happy to have $2 million left over and give back to the town. This has all come down in, I think it was probably the middle of November, mm-hmm. when NASDAQ, the people that do these numbers, came back and say, oh my gosh, you're way different today than you were 4 years ago. Mm. And that's when this started. And in terms of the construction, part of the reason we're low and could even be lower under budget was the site was much better than we anticipated. All of us drove by that place for 50 years and said it's just a big swamp, you can't build anything there, it's awful wet. As it turns out, water hasn't been an issue at all. Mm-hmm. And the other thing in Hopkinton that we have lots of is ledge, and there's no ledge there. So those two things kind of accelerated the construction cycle. So probably 80% of the foundation is done. It's not a foundation like you think of as a house foundation. It's a frost wall. There's no basement. But 80% of the scum. So probably a month ago when this first came about and we said, oh my gosh, what are we going to do? And thankfully, you guys proposed a special town meeting. The timing worked out great. They were about to start that in. They're still working there, but they hadn't poured any of that portion of the foundation. So essentially, the architects came up and said, okay, this is what the expansion was going to be. The classrooms are in modules of 4 classrooms, 2 down, 2 up. And what they've done is they've taken the end of the building, pushed it out 28 feet, slid a module in there, and that gives us the 4 extra classrooms. Just timing-wise, it's great. Could we wait? If we waited 5 years and did the same thing, it would probably be twice the cost. Not only that, but you'd have the disruption to the school at the same time, and Hayden Row Street would still be covered with dirt from trucks coming and going for the addition. It's just a good time to do it. But that's, we got a good contractor.
The site is much better than we anticipated it was, and we're right on schedule. So,
I'd echo that the timing is really the key here. This is a tremendous opportunity for us, because the fact that these numbers came in mid-November, I think actually we were here shortly after they came out and had some discussions around the budget where we talked about we were seeing this spike. So we've had to move very quickly, and the professionals we have moved extremely quickly to get us a lot of the design work. But thankfully, as Mike said, we did have the special town meeting, so this will allow us to really build a school that will accommodate that growth from the day it opens.
Mr. Catino.
I know additions from doing Golden Pond, and I know that they're not fun, much less start from scratch. But so is the square foot cost, is that in line with what we're doing?
Well, the square foot, it's close, but okay. It's not a fair thing, because there is significant site work that has to be done to accommodate the addition. So the square foot-wise, you can't do it. The other thing that the community has to be aware of is we got good bids and we got good numbers. So whenever you change something, consider an addition you do at your house, you say, oh, geez, now I want to put a skylight in. Well, that skylight that at the beginning might have cost you $200, and if the guy is under budget, he says, well, I'll do the skylight for $400. So it's an opportunity. You know, they're not taking advantage of us, you know, but there's an opportunity there for them to make up for a little bit of shortcoming, because the budget we have is a hard budget. It can't waver. It can't get any more. So what they bid is what they bid. The only thing that can change it is if we change something.
So my next question is, I think you said that we were designed in for 8 additional classrooms?
8.
And so we still have expansion of 4.
Yes.
Should we be...
The numbers don't support it.
It's okay. So, they're not going to give us the money anyway.
Yeah.
And now it's the cheapest time to do it, and you guys were right with the numbers originally.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Just like go back to your original thought saying, look, hey, we had the numbers right. They cut us down. And
The reality is that if you add these 4 additional classrooms, you're going to get class sizes right down into the range we're looking for, which is 18-20 for kindergarten and first grade. You add an additional 4 classrooms. I mean, obviously, even smaller class sizes are great, but you also have to make sort of the fiscally responsible decisions. And the numbers and growth don't support it. And, you know, who knows? We could be talking in 4 years and, you know, or 10 years, and this could be going, you know, this could be going the other way. And we have, so I think that's why we landed on the 4, because according to what the numbers are telling us, and this is not 2-year, 3-year numbers, these are 10-year projections, that we think that this is a good number.
Yeah, these are the questions that are coming to me.
Yep.
So great, thanks very much, appreciate it.
Okay.
Yeah, so I had a probably a 45-minute conversation with Mr. Shepherd about this one day. And first of all, to say that the committee that they've put together, excluding me, is they're workhorses. They really are. They're workhorses on this. And you know, we're lucky to have the people in all these different aspects, and they're working great with the contractors and all the subs. And for a project of this size to be coming in $2 million under budget is unheard of. But it is, and I'm sure it's through constant monitoring and having them sharpen the pencils for their bids. And so with the 4 classrooms, with the net being $1.5 million, you know, if this study came out in 7 months and said the same thing, you're going to be short, it would have been at least double.
Mm-hmm.
It's just so fortunate right now that we're able to do this, and that the contractors are able to do this. And you know, it's a hard pill to swallow for a lot of people. I mean, this thing, this phone and my email and everything goes off the hook when anything like this goes on. You know, the people that are just drop anchor, stop spending, no. But this really does make sense. And Mike Shepherd is a guy that I trust as much as anyone in this town. When I spent 45 minutes with him on the phone explaining, you know, he was explaining to me the ins and outs of it. It really is a no-brainer. So, you know, I'm good with it and looking forward to town meeting, maybe.
Okay. Anybody else? Any other thoughts? Good, Lori?
At the size that it was approved originally, it was 395 students, did you say, or something like that? What were the average class size is going to be with the classrooms there that were approved?
Based on the numbers now, or based on the numbers at the time?
Based on the approved numbers. So 395
students fit into that 18 to 20. That 18 to 20 class size category. So they size the school based on what our strategic plan says are the targets for that. At the time, 395 wasn't drastically off from the projections that we had. They have a slightly different formula they use, but I think it was only off by like 20 students or so. It wasn't drastically off at the time from the NESDEC numbers that we had. So we were right in that 18 to 20 range, and we felt like at the time that we could deal with that. The 11th classroom for each grade level was really big for us. This differential that we got in November of 2016 it's 50 kids. So yeah.
Yep. Okay. Lori, did you have anything?
Oh no, I thought you were pointing to me to have something to say, but one, I have no voice, and two,
you're good.
Given you everything.
Okay. All right, so the chair will entertain a motion to support Article 2 at the special town meeting, specific to the elementary school addition.
So moved. Second.
We have a motion by Mr. Catino and a second by Mr. Sestari. Any discussion? All those in favor? Aye. Aye. Any opposed?
Thank you. Folks.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Article 3. So Article 3 is specific to 61 Main Street. Basically the CVS location, and the question that we have previously voted to support, or at least maybe not the question, but the concept of starting and looking into, and possibly, which this motion says, it's not we have to, it's a possibility, that the land needed to straighten the intersection at Main Street and Hayden Row, or Grove Street rather, would be taken. I'll read it. I move the town vote to authorize the Board of Selectmen to acquire by gift, purchase, or eminent domain pursuant to Mass General Law upon terms and conditions, blah, blah, blah. So the motion that we should make tonight is to support the town moving forward with possibly taking land by eminent domain.
Mr. Chair,
straighten the intersection.
Didn't we already vote on this?
We have voted to take action in the past to get it to this point, to get it on the article.
The fact that we're the ones who are putting it on the warrant shows our support for it.
Yeah.
Okay, so we have five members, nobody's saying anything different. Yep. So with that, Mr. Kamala, we have voted this previously, so we don't need to vote it again like we did similar to Article 1, correct? Or do you want us to vote the motion, the motion?
The latter. I think the board should vote to support the motion.
Okay.
Then I'll make a motion to support Article 3, the acquisition of property at 61 Main Street by gift, purchase, or eminent domain for a fee or other interest.
Second.
Okay, so we have a motion by Mr. Catino and a second by Mr. Tedstone. Okay. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? So it's unanimous and so carries. Article 4 is specific to a solar agreement with the town of Hopkinton. I'm going to recuse myself given my profession. Mr. Catino.
Is it possible I can ask a quick question about the last one? Just a real quick question.
Sure, real quick.
Just wondering, because you were looking at getting Dave Paul, you were looking at getting an appraisal on the property. Is there
all that'll be part of a process, Dave, that happens down the road.
Yeah, just curious. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Catino.
Okay, Article 4, the authority to negotiate solar agreements. The article reads, to see if the town will vote to authorize the Board of Selectmen to negotiate payment in lieu of tax for pilot agreements for solar energy products in the town of Hopkinton in accordance with Section 38H of Chapter 59 of the Massachusetts General Laws. Could you give us some insight?
Yes. Owing to a recent change in the Department of Revenue regulations, towns are now required to go through a two-step process in handling solar projects i.e. if a town is inclined to sign a pilot agreement with a solar developer, there must be two votes at town meeting. The first vote is the authorization given to the selectmen to enter into negotiations and agreements. And then the second vote in the future is the affirmation by town meeting that the agreement that the selectmen enter into is appropriate for the town. So it's a two-step process. First step is receiving approval from town meeting to even begin the negotiations. And then the second vote is if there's a specific agreement reached, that town meeting ratifies that agreement. What we are now proposing is you go to town meeting and receive the blanket agreement or approval from town meeting for the selectmen to enter into negotiations with any solar provider.
Anybody have any?
Yeah. Could you kind of explain to me what is in it for us? Why do we want to do this? From what I've read, often pilot agreements, particularly in cities such as Boston that have a lot of tax-exempt properties, such as universities and hospitals who actually are using town services, have developed pilot agreements to get some kind of compensation for the tax revenue that has been foregone. That's not the case in these type of installations that I can see. I know we've had a couple already go into town without pilot agreements, so it doesn't appear that there is any lack of incentive for these organizations to want to build in Hopkinton. What's in it for us? Why would we want to do this as opposed to just using the normal mechanism for collecting property taxes, which would be due to the town?
Let me say this in a neutral way. I think the main incentive is preemptive. Whether solar companies pay taxes, property taxes or not, is an issue that is being contested. And what most towns have done is proactively enter into agreements where if the decision in the future is that they don't pay taxes as we anticipate them to, that there will be an agreement that obligates them to do so. That's the incentive for towns to do this.
So you're saying, if I may, Mr. Chairman, yes, that the existing solar projects planned in the town right now, just so I understand, the land that they're on right now is not tax exempt, but because there's priority in the state being given to solar, that they may in the future be considered tax exempt and we would get no tax revenue from them, and this allows us some tax revenue.
Correct, and in addition, that decision may be a legal decision too.
Oh, just a follow-on question. Now, again, some cities and towns have executed pilot agreements, as I said, with existing tax-exempt organizations like hospitals and universities because they use town services. So we are looking forward, expecting that this might be the case. Right now, they would be paying taxes. So what would prevent us, if that happened, to then negotiating a pilot agreement to compensate for that, such as, say, like Boston has tried to do with tax-exempt entities like universities and hospitals? Couldn't we go back and do it forward and right now get what's due to us?
In my estimation, the solar companies may not have the incentive to do that in the future.
Yeah, the way I understand it is that if they... Why should they come to the table? They already have it for nothing.
Okay, just one last question. The amount of tax revenue that a town would get through a pilot agreement, I know, I guess it's negotiated, and I think it's usually, what, over 20 years or so. How does that compare as a rule to what a town would normally get under other circumstances? Is it somewhat comparable? Is it significantly less? What would our bottom line be?
The amounts vary depending on the method of taxation that the agreement identifies. The they are possibly, and Chris, feel through the chair, feel free to jump in here. I believe there are either two or three different ways that this has been approached. There is a method that is advantageous, comes closer to what they may pay. Mm-hmm. Generally in Texas, there are other methods that are advantageous to the solar company.
Just a comment. I had looked at a solar company pilot agreement with the town of Douglas that was done. It's up online. And that stated that the revenue was estimated to be roughly equivalent over the period to what would be normally paid. But I guess that's not always the case. That's up for grabs.
Exactly. Yeah.
Okay, so the chair, in that case, will entertain a motion to Article 4, the authority to negotiate solar agreements.
Second.
Further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Motion passes unanimously. Mr. Chairman.
There is no candy out there anywhere. I just looked into every drawer possible.
Well, that's because it's in my pocket.
Another pepper in it? Another pepper?
There's a camera out there. I've just been bagged. Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chair, Mr. Vice Chair, for getting through that. So that concludes our 2017 annual town meeting.
Special
town meeting. Yes. Votes of support or not, which I think we did. Okay, number 9 on the agenda, board liaison reports and board invites.
Chair, number 8. I'm seeking a vote from the board to consider opening the 2017.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah. I just crossed off the wrong one. Okay, item number 8, the board will consider opening the 2017 annual town meeting warrant. Any questions? Chair will entertain a motion.
I'd just like to make a comment.
Okay.
Like the town manager, to keep in mind that, first of all, knowing that directors of departments in town are able to put articles on the warrant, and the fact that most of those directors report to you, I'd like for you to really make sure that they all are knowledgeable of the fact that the town has spent and voted to spend a lot of money over the last couple of annual town meetings. And while I can't speak for the board, I will say that any of the extra type stuff, I certainly don't have any appetite for this year, and likely for the next few years until we really start to see what the impact is of our votes for the last couple of years. Mm-hmm. And again, I don't know how the rest of the board feels, but without question, over the last couple of years, we've voted to spend a lot of money, and I get the sense that the board will be taking that into consideration in their support of various articles as we go into annual town meeting.
Okay. Thank you. Mr.
Yes.
Mall.
No, point well taken.
Thanks. Any other comments? So the chair will entertain a motion to open the 2017 annual town meeting warrant.
And sorry, Mr. Chair,
Yes. On March 1st, 2017, we're going to open it January 24th, 2017, and we're going to close it on March 1st, 2017. So that's the motion.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second, open and close on those dates. Mr. Kamali, give with the motion.
Yes.
All those in favor?
Any further discussion?
Oh, I got ahead of myself. It's the candy. I've got energy now. Mr. Sestari, we haven't voted yet.
Is that typically how the length of time that we keep that open? Yeah.
Yes.
Seems like a long time.
There's a requirement number of days.
Yeah.
How many days is it? Is that about 40? Yes.
We have 6.
35?
Yeah. 35. We close it as it, I think it's, I'll have to check my notes in terms of.
Mr. Deegan.
Yeah, but.
Come on up and join us for a sec, Connor. Please.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. To the town manager's point, it is 60 days that we have to have the annual town meeting warrant open before we can close on all proposed articles that have been given.
Excellent. Thank you.
That doesn't sound right. We're not opening it for 60 days today, until March 1st.
It does not. It effectively, from what I was just doing some research actually earlier today, just to make sure everything was right on the timelines, okay. And it goes from the date of the election itself for the annual town election that's connected on the same warrant.
So we have to close within 60 days of the town meeting.
We have to close within 60 days. So
of the close of town meeting, which closes on
the warrant closes 60 days before the town meeting, and that's when all petitions have to be submitted and any articles need to be submitted.
So it doesn't have to be open a certain amount of time. It just has to be closed within 60 days of the start of the meeting.
Right. Right. No,
there's an additional point, if I may, through the chair.
Please.
Per the town selectman's policy, it's 90 days before annual town meeting. That's the answer to the question.
So
how many days before? 90 days before.
Open it.
Yes. Open it 90
days before.
Yeah.
And we have to close it inside of 60 days of the end.
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah.
And I'm sorry, 90 days before town meeting opens or closes?
Opens.
Opens. And yes. Town meeting, the date of town meeting is this year?
May 5th.
Oh, May 1st. First.
May 1st,
May
1st. Sorry.
Oh,
yeah.
May 1st?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
So we have a motion on the table and a second. We've clarified the dates. Any further discussion?
Yeah, you're not good with eating with your mouth full.
My mumbling.
All
those in favor.
The close of the warrant has to be within 60 days.
It's 60.
Town election. And the town election is middle of May, right? May what?
15th.
So March 1st is not within 60 days of May 15th.
How do you know that?
It's 60 days before the annual town meeting.
Before
that's why
the annual town meeting.
Yes, oh, that's why we chose March 1st, 2017.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you. Just making sure we have everything straight. Okay, that's 60, perfect. Okay.
Yes.
Just want to make sure. Thank you.
Math major.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? It's unanimous and so carries. Number 9.
Someone hit their mic.
Pull his ear.
Everybody okay? I think somebody. Did I hit my mic?
I think I coughed and I threw his eardrum out.
Oh. Sorry about that. I was on the board once, and a member occasionally would get bored, and he'd start messing with the HCAM folks. So he'd grab his mic and just keep scratching it like this, just to do something. It was a long time ago. No names shall be mentioned. Board liaison reports and invites. Let's cover invites first. Did I see an invite come across the screen here in the last day or two?
I believe so. I remember yesterday discussing an invite with Maria. I don't remember specifically what it was for. Let me check my email.
Okay, let's go to liaisons then while Mr. Kamal just checks that out real quick.
EHOP. It was through the EHOP.
Yes, educate, yes.
The EHOP traffic mitigation.
Yep. Public safety.
Yeah, okay. And when is that?
February 6th at the Center for the Arts at 7 p.m., which is a Monday.
Okay. Mr. Sestari, liaison.
Just down to our final two meetings for the Charter Review Committee, possibly the final two, I should say. But we have one tomorrow, just tidying up the presentation for a special town meeting, and then we have a special town meeting. After that, of course, if things pass at special town meeting, I'm sure we'll get together a couple more times between then and annual town meeting.
Okay. All good?
Actually, yeah.
Mrs. Wright.
All good tonight.
Mr. Catino.
Over the weekend, I went to the I was at the town's representative at the Massachusetts Municipal Association meeting. It was very informative. I got to meet a lot of other selectmen and town managers from the other 351 cities and towns. But we discussed methods of increasing state school funding and getting more local control of zoning requirements. It was definitely a great thing to attend. I'm glad I went.
I was listening to the governor on the way here, and he said that they have been increasing the funding for schools.
That they aren't?
That they have been.
That's where they were discussing other methods, other things that they could, other avenues or other resources.
Okay.
Okay. All good? Mr. Tedstone.
Well, you heard the elementary school building committee. They were here. That's all I got.
Okay. And yeah, mine was all covered this evening with a couple of the articles, so nothing to report. So on this invite for EHOP, it's February 7th, okay? February 6th, sorry. I'd be interested. Do we have a meeting on the 7th?
We have a meeting on the 14th.
Okay, so I'm going to try and get that EHOP thing. That's going to be interesting.
Yeah, Chief Lee, John Westerling,
me.
Elaine. Yeah, we'll be the keynote speakers.
And that's at the CAA?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Town manager's report, Mr. Kamal.
Yes. I shared with you yesterday the proposed preliminary FY18 budget, including the list of capital articles that have been reviewed by CIC, as well as the CFO and myself. And with your permission, Mr. Chair, Chris Sandini, the CFO, is here with us tonight. With your permission, can you please participate in this discussion?
Sure, join Chris, you would please join us at the guest table.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And I felt it was important that we share the preliminary budget with the board for at least two reasons. One, as we've been saying over the past, I think, 3-4 months, this is going to be a different budget year. This is the year when our debt service really shows up in our model. And secondly, we're also responding to prior comments from the board that, similar to what we had done in prior years, you needed to see the budget much earlier. And that's why we're here today. We're here today just to talk about the big picture issues, what we're seeing in the budget. We have received the school numbers. Chris and I have met with the department heads, gone through their budgets. We have a pretty good idea as to where the budget is, and that's what we're presenting to you today. Chris is here to walk you through the financial model, as well as explain some of the assumptions that we're building into the budget.
This is not your formal submission to the Board of Selectmen, so I think in the interest of time, if we could take the input that we received tonight from our colleagues, and then let's noodle on it for a meeting or two till we actually get a formal presentation from the town manager. This will give you some direction about some things if you want to start working on as individual members or looking into. But I'd rather we not sort of get into the whole, you know, deliberation tonight. Mr. Kamal.
And so with that in mind, I think perhaps we should let Chris launch right into explaining the assumptions behind the budget, as well as the numbers that we're seeing through the submissions and how they're reflected in the town's financial model. Clearly, there's an interest in learning about the prospective tax impact, and we can explain what the drivers are behind the number that Chris will identify.
Please.
Well, there are a couple of large drivers. There's a page in your presentation that lists the assumptions, and there's also another one that gives you a quick snapshot of the largest increases in the major categories. Number one, with the school department being approximately 55% of the general fund budget, 56%, even a 4% increase is going to push that number up. Debt service being a 10% component, which is pretty remarkable for FY18, going up 56% in 1 year is also going to increase. Those are going to be the two that are going to bring everything else way up. You'll also see in the summary that there are fairly large increases for both FY19. It levels down a little bit on FY18, levels down a little on FY19, and then continues to go down. That doesn't mean that everything is great. It just means that once you're up there, things don't look so bad because the rate of increase is reduced. But it's still a rather large tax burden for each of those ensuing years. Those are the two. Everything in the debt service has been, you know, worked on quite a bit to make sure it's all inclusive. Anything we haven't issued so far for Center School and any of the other projects has been taken into account, as well as the capital plan going into the future for future projects has also been taken into account for this. One little fact that kind of drives things home is we had two particular debt issues. We had one in May for $16 million, and we had one in December for $24.5 million. That added a total of $3.6 million in debt service to the 2018 budget alone.
So just to remind everybody, new elementary school, possibly a little addition to that, new library, new DPW facility, and the land the land actually was spoken before, covered before, right? But those three buildings right there are a significant investment the community's making. And Chris is just outlining the cost now that the taxpayers, you know, will cover in the next few years as we get these things in the ground and up and running. Okay?
And the reason there are pilot agreements for the solar, I didn't want to interrupt you, but it's because there's so much up in the air on the type of taxation, whether it's personal property or real estate. There's cases all over the place from community to community. The state thought that it would be wise to put to level it out a little bit and get communities an understanding on what they can expect to receive from these, because there are several court cases that have been spawned. It also makes a lot of sense in that the state has a tendency to exempt solar projects, and the next ones they may exempt are the power generators, which would leave Hopkinton with nothing. So it makes a lot of sense for them to do it for that reason, too.
Okay. Anything else?
I think it needs to be said that based on the numbers we're looking at, the projected tax impact net of new growth in FY18 will be 5.78, of which a substantial part is the debt service.
Okay. And we're going to get further clarification on all this going forward in the budget season.
Yep.
But that's the magnitude of the situation that we're currently facing.
Yep.
Okay. Any sort of high-level questions, things you want to understand tonight so you can dig into it further between now and our next budget presentation? Okay. You guys okay for now? Okay.
Yeah. Excuse me?
So it's a lot in the pay as you go.
There were a lot of assumptions that I had to make, and Norman and I made, that, you know, reasonable people will disagree, and we're open to suggestions from them.
Yeah. I think you're going to get a couple.
Yeah. I'm sure I will.
Yeah. And to your point, that's also reflective of what we're projecting free cash to be.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, I understand that. Mm. But it doesn't change the fact that it's a lot of days ago.
Yes.
Yeah. And some of that might be some of the things that you were referencing earlier, right? At least from my perspective, anyway.
Yeah. And also, so that the board is aware of this, we are in conversations with our colleagues on the school side to see if they can identify capital projects that are covered in their operating budget with the idea of let's identify those projects and perhaps fund them differently.
Well, I think, yeah.
But that just adds to the pay-as-you-go or the debt service.
Yeah.
I also look at things and see technology, system-wide technology upgrades at 100,000, but a separate line item for wireless access points for another 80,000. To me, that's all really, it's 180,000 going to technology upgrades for the schools. That's a lot in 1 year.
Okay, with that, I would suggest we table this for now.
Yeah.
We've got some things to chew on. I think there's some nice assumptions made there. That's, we know what happens when you make assumptions, right? I mean, that's part of what you got to do, but when you assume, things happen, right?
Yeah.
So we'll leave it at that for now, and we'll come back to it soon. Mr. Kamal.
Mr. Chair, I know I did not warn you about this, but I'm just thinking about this now, that realizing this is an unusual budget here, realizing also that we may require some combined effort to get this budget to where we all are comfortable.
Yeah.
I would like to suggest a separate meeting just to focus on the budget.
I think that's a good idea, and I was thinking the same, so I'm glad you brought it up.
So with the okay from the rest of the board, we can work with the chair to schedule that.
Yeah, everybody okay with that? I mean, I like the board's cadence is over the last few years has gotten really good. We are pretty strict in what we do and when we meet and how we do things, and I think a lot of that goes to the fact that we've got experienced people in the town manager's office in Norman and Elaine. But in years past, we would have all kinds of extra meetings. So it's nice that we don't, but I think it makes sense to have one for this particular budget and really get into the details. Mr. Sestari.
Can I just ask the context of this line item? Under the, okay, so this is capital project requests. So there's going to be a request for $4 million for a new turf field with lights.
Yes, in fact.
So I guess not everybody thinks that we've been spending a lot of money over the last couple of years.
Yeah, in fact, that project, I don't have the details to it, but I believe it's going to be rolled out in phases. This could be phase one.
Or a portion of that could be phase one.
Where is that field going to be located, at the high school or Fruit Street?
That's all up for discussion. We ready to table it now?
Please do.
Thank goodness. Okay, so we're going to table this for future meetings, and obviously we're going to set one, I think, if everyone's okay with that, specifically to get into the budget and the capital articles. Okay, anything else, Mr. Kamal?
For now, no.
Okay, future board agenda items.
Thanks, Chris.
Thank you. I'm all set right now.
Mrs. Ray.
Yep.
Mr. Sestari.
At some point, I want to talk about turf field with lights.
Mm-hmm. I'm sure you'll have plenty of opportunities to do so. Yeah. With that, the chair will entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Seconded.
We have moved and seconded. Discussion. All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you all. Have a great night.
Thank you.
Chair, I am not going to be here for February 14th. So.